Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
Welcome, my friends. We are live. Thank you so much for joining us. It is the 26th day of August, 2011, on this Friday edition. We're going to have wide open phones throughout the entire 3 hours of the transmission today. And, of course, we have our weekly visit on the economy and the geopolitical developments with Bob Chapman, our regular Friday guest, in the third hour today. Ben Bernanke came out and said, we're not going to do QE3. But as Dr. Paul Craig Roberts said yesterday, they're already engaging in different types of stealth QE3 with the private Federal Reserve, buying with fiat made-up digital numbers 70-plus percent and growing of U.S. Treasury bonds. Now, Bernanke's also called on Congress for another stimulus. So that's something that will also increase, obviously, the debt and pump more dollars into the economy, not actually growing the real economy, just devaluing currency further. It will slow the slide into abject depression in the short term, but in the end only make it worse when it finally completely melts down. And that's what we've been telling you for over 3 years with the last two stimuluses and all the different banker bailouts and the things that we've seen. And when there is a bailout of General Motors, they move to China, they move to Brazil, they move to Eastern Europe. It's the same thing with these big mega banks. They're given trillions and trillions of dollars, and then they basically just take that money, hoard it, and don't loan it out to the public. So we're going to be going over that financial news. Stocks declined when Fed offers no new measures. So they're officially announcing the end of the QE2. You know, we ought to get Max Keiser just to pop in for 10 minutes sometime today, because I want to get his view on that. We ought to give him a ring and see if he could join us on the phone or via Skype from his home. If not, we'll probably get him to pop in Sunday with us. Obviously, we'll get Bob Chapman's take on that, but I like to get multiple views on the situation. Now, I saw two articles out. NYPD confirms CIA officer works at department. This is out of the Associated Press. This is completely illegal. And actually, Homeland Security has admitted, since before it existed officially, before it was given cabinet power in 2002, the fledgling organization in late 2001 admitted that they had CIA agents in every major city and even many small towns. This is an organization caught trafficking narcotics, weapons worldwide, engaged in every form of just absolute evil you can imagine. That is the actual field operatives. The analysts are a different group altogether, more diverse. NYPD confirms CIA officer works at department. And of course, there's several federal laws barring that, but federal laws aren't to be followed. There's a lot of laws against warrantless wiretapping of citizens, but they do it. And here's another one. CIA demands cuts in book about 911 and terror fight. They're demanding a whole bunch of stuff be cut out of memoirs of an FBI agent. Well, what is that their business here domestically? We all know that the CIA obviously knows the truth about 9/11. Low-grade moron who's looked at the facts will know the truth about 9/11, and the CIA knows that they are up to their eyeballs in it and with al-Qaeda all over the world. Speaking of al-Qaeda all over the world, I want to pull up the articles because I just saw this before I went live. They came and plopped a new article down in front of me. But remember our military sources, Infowars.com, military sources, ground invasion in late September or early October. Here's the quote. Qaddafi feared a U.S. full-scale ground invasion in late September or October. So showing they were getting the same information we were getting from military sources. All right, we'll be right back. Big transmission lined up today. Oh, and Lou Rockwell coming up.
He's the T-Rex of political talk. Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network.
It is Friday, my friends. The 26th day of August, 2011. We are, of course, moving quickly towards the 10th anniversary of the tragic events of 9/11. And we're going to go through a special report dealing with the fact a little bit later in the broadcast that the 9/11 first responders have been barred from the ceremony. I know I've been talking a lot about this because it is just so incredibly outrageous that they're not going to have any of them there. They said they will recognize them, perhaps having a fire chief or police chief there who will thank them. The big question, this tells you so much, is why aren't they allowed to be there? When I open the phones up, I'd like to get your view on that, and then obviously any other subjects you want to raise. Also, there's another report that's up at Infowars.com from here in Austin, Texas, and I've got Paul Watson writing a blurb. And the reason the phones aren't open yet is that I know he's a daily listener and calls in when he can get through routinely. You've heard him announce himself as Ronnie Reeferseed, and he does that to brand himself as a hemp activist who talks about how it's a better cash crop than even cotton and can produce wonderful biofuels. Well, man banned from Austin City Council by mayor for stating his name. And Drudge, obviously, earlier in the week thought it was pretty newsworthy that we did an article about an Ohio congressman at a public town hall telling people no video cameras allowed, quote, to protect his constituents and not embarrass anyone, because he knew there were some people there that disagreed with him and were sitting there peacefully, mainly old ladies, in their seats from an activist group that wanted to ask him questions. So the cops went over and manhandled people and took their cameras. And you've seen Quartzsite, where Citizens Communication, you try to get up and say, I don't want my taxes raised. And they say, sorry, I don't like you saying that. You're arrested. And the mayor's like, but it's the rules. It's state law. She's being polite. She's trying to speak. And they just said, you're fired too, mayor. But you can't fire the mayor. Yeah, we got the police. Police, take them out of here. I mean, I'm seeing these type of events every couple days now. And so the phones are not open yet, except for Ronnie Reeferseed, if he wants to call in. Now, he's called before and said, Alex, in fact, he came down to the Capitol at one of our demonstrations against the TSA, one of our stormings of the Capitols. He said, why am I banned from your show? And you're not banned. You get on sometimes. It's just that if I'm saying first-time callers and then I go to somebody and clearly it's you disguising your voice, I'm saying first-time callers. That's their time to call in. But we'd love to hear from you now, Ronnie Reeferseed, and we'll play that clip if and when you call in. 800-259-9231. John Harmon knows his voice well, so no one try to impersonate Ronnie Reeferseed. He's a nice fellow. I'm quite eloquent when he actually covers issues. But he's been thrown out of the county commissioners for trying to talk. He's polite. He's been thrown out of the city council. You know, the city council in Austin has done what many councils have done around the country. You can speak on any agenda item, but now they publish it a week before and make you go down in person and sign up to speak for your 3 minutes. And then they'll get up and walk away when you're speaking. We've had doctors fly in, like Dr. Conant, to say, council, I've brought another scientist with me. Your own FDA scientists have gone public, as well as EPA scientists, and have said it's deadly and causing massive bone cancer increases. I'd like to give you these documents. And the mayor just gets up and walks off or ignores them. And this is part of their arrogance. I remember when I went down to the city council, I don't know, 5-6 years ago, it's in my film Matrix of Evil, and we had hundreds and hundreds of people down there to try to get the city council to pass a resolution saying they'll follow the Bill of Rights and Constitution and nullify the Patriot Act at the county and city level. And hundreds of cities, by now it's over 800, four states had done similar things. And I got up to speak, and I'd been given the time. They've since, I'm told, gotten rid of that, where people can basically try to give you their time. Sometimes they'll allow it, sometimes they don't. And I'd been given people's time, so I had like 15 minutes. And the mayor just said, I've got to go, but I'll be listening, you know, in the back room. And they all laughed. It was very, very funny. But I got up and I think gave one of my best ever heartfelt speeches to them. And I said, this is not a laughing matter. This is not a game. You get rid of the Bill of Rights and Constitution. None of us are safe. This is what makes America, America. Please do the right thing and pass this resolution. And they did narrowly pass it. Max Kaiser is going to be popping in at 11:30 for just about 10 minutes. And then at 12:30, we're going to have Lou Rockwell on. It is taped, but it's premiering on the radio here for everyone. What we're going to be doing with the nightly TV show that officially kicks off next Thursday, September 1st, 7 p.m. Central every night, is we're going to basically take clips, say, if Ron Paul's on or if Lou Rockwell's on or Max Kaiser or any of the regular guests we have, but many, many other guests. We're lining up just dozens and dozens of really informative people to be on the show every night. Sometimes we'll have several interviews, news packages. If you want to see something close to what you're going to be seeing next week, it's the special report we did last night that is now posted for members at prisonplanet.tv. Like, let me just go to prisonplanet.tv. I don't even know what we called the special report last night. It aired from like 7 to 8 o'clock last night. But again, if you go to prisonplanet.tv, it's not posted up there yet. I mean, I know it's posted in the live show area, because you have this radio show that's 3 hours long every day posted as a second show right now. These special reports are going as like a second show, so it's in the daily show archive area. You'll just see two shows for the day. But then normally Paul makes a banner and then posts it up there so people can find that specifically. We're reworking the site. It's going to launch early next week. Where it's a lot easier to navigate for people that are new users. It would have already happened, but one of our programmers was out, the family issue. So we're very, very close to that. But I talked to Watson earlier because I'm getting a lot of emails and a lot of calls and a lot of comments and like every article. It's like, where is it? You know, it needs to be in a special report area. It needs to be in a live area. It needs to be somewhere where we can get to it easier. And I know you can go right up the top of prisonplanet.tv, and you can click on the Alex Jones live area, and then there's the archive of it. I understand that. But it again, we have a new system where the nightly news is in one spot clearly on its own page. The special reports are on another page. The daily radio / TV show, Alex Jones Live, we're calling it, that's going to be in its own area. Because we're so busy producing all this media and then, like, burying it. I'm going to call Watson right now. I know, you know, in between his hundreds of duties, he is. He told me right before I went live that it was there, so I could direct people to that. The point is that we're going to take clips. We're going to take clips. And hold on 1 second, Paul. We're going to take clips and really powerful pieces of the nightly news, and then air it on the radio every day. So even if you're not a PrisonPlanet.tv member, you'll get some of the key news and highlights here. Hey, Paul, I'm getting massive feedback. I know we're about to do the relaunch of PrisonPlanet.tv next week because we've added all these new features and they get added into... No, I know it's in video reports link, but people don't know that. I mean, if you go to PrisonPlanet.tv, show them right there, top of the site, home, latest news, Alex Jones Live, trailers, media, subscribe now. Where's the video report area? There it is. It's now up. So it was up. Watson was right. I guess my computer didn't refresh. Well, good job, Watson. See, when I hit refresh, it says eugenics special. But there it is. Ron Paul 2012 special report with Lou Rockwell. Watson, are you excited about the fact we're going to have the site reworked and stuff next week? No, you're not on the air. We're having a private conversation right now here on the radio. This is the new system here. everything, total transparency. By the way, I'm going to let listeners know, we are considering mounting live cameras with a whole nother feed out there in the control room and mounting cameras throughout the office. I'm not kidding. That's the next phase of total InfoWars. You will literally be in the office. Watson's going to have cameras mounted at his house. How's that sound, Watson? He just said he's going to have one mounted on his forehead. All right, I'll call you back, buddy. I'll see you. Oh, man. Take care. I don't know what's wrong with my computers in here. I got two different computers, and they never refresh. And in there, they all refresh. Anyways, it's called Ron Paul 2012 Report, and that's how I just digressed for 5 minutes, was trying to discover the name of it. We were up here working until, I don't know, about 8 o'clock last night or so. Or no, I guess 8:30 or so. And I took the guys out for some wicked red meat. But what a great crew we have. Okay, that's enough from there. I'm going to reset. We're going to go to break. We're going to come back and get into the news. But the point I was making, Max Keiser's coming up on what this announcement of no QE3 means. But as Dr. Roberts said, they're still doing it pretty much. It's not by stealth. They just don't call it QE3. And you saw Greenspan say a few weeks ago, he said, we'll just print money. We're not going to default. So that's a big issue that we're going to be discussing briefly with Keiser. Then I've got about a 15-minute interview I did with Lou Rockwell that we're going to be playing at the bottom of the next hour after we take some of your calls. And then Bob Chapman will be joining us on The Economy and taking your phone calls. All of this and more coming up today. But again, if you are not a PrisonPlanet.tv member, if you are not a PrisonPlanet.tv member, it's awesome. It's got 8 years of material. You can download the stuff, give it to people. You can share your passcode with up to 6 people, wink, wink, and a lot more. So stay with us. We'll be right back.
I'll stop there.
Okay, you will stop there.
But for weekly
you
updates...
You will stop. Step back.
No,
your
wait.
Time is up.
I didn't make a sound, sir. We're not going to let him do this. Look, call 1-888-699-NEWS to find out for weekly update, for to subscribe to American Free Press. And for weekly updates... What?
Here come the cops.
What did I do? What am I doing?
Okay, what you're watching and listening to is a local Austin activist who goes by Ronnie Reeferseed, and he's branded himself as that. It actually does get him attention, and he's a hemp activist. And a lot of you have heard him as a caller into this show, and he was listening, and he did call in, because on all three Austin news channels this morning this was on television. It was on radio on every channel I tuned into, 590 AM. 93.7 KLBJ. I tuned into another station driving in. This is all they're talking about in Austin, is why did the mayor have this guy drug out by police and banned for 1 year from coming into the Austin City Council? And then I'm told some of the other activists that were there who just said, hey, that's not right, they were thrown out and banned for a period. And to tell us exactly what happened is the man himself, Ronnie Reeferseed. This is what we see in Ohio at a public meeting, and the congressman saying, police, take these old ladies' cameras who are peaceably sitting there taping, but letting the news continue to film. This is what we see in Quartzsite, Arizona. All over the country, government saying, you can't sell tomatoes on a street corner. There's been more arrests and fines today with people selling lemonade across the country from California to Massachusetts. This is going on everywhere. You can't have a garden in your front yard. Now you can't have it in your backyard. Even if you live in a rural area, they're saying you can't have chickens now. I saw that report yesterday. Government thinks that it owns us, and Lee Liffingwell is an absolute joke. He's one of these Tarrytown little globalist minions busy handing our infrastructure over to the New World Order trying to take over our roads for toll companies. What a joke of a city council we have. What a sickening display of petty tyrants. But Austin deserves it because you let these scum do it. In fact, let's play a clip of Leffingwell being a tyrant, then we'll go back to Ronnie Reefer Seed. Let's play that clip. Here it is. You'll need to turn it up.
Mona Gonzalez, they'll be ordering the chamber or we'll clear the chamber.
All right, we're going to get to more of this later because let's just go to Ronnie Reefer Seed. Ronnie, exactly what happened?
Well, thank you, sir. Yes, it was, as you were saying, I was, as usual, trying to introduce myself as I usually do. And that is, of course, Ronnie Reefer Seed. And that's relatively mild. Now, what I'd recently done was I put a raspberry on the end of it with the fingers coming out of my ears, wiggling my finger, you know, the thumbs of my ears, wiggling my fingers. That one little added extra level step to it took the mayor out of his chair and he just blew up like a spoiled child and said, no, we can't do it. You can't do that. That offends me.
That's right. And you can't defile his supreme parasiticness. And so you're meant to grovel. You don't go before an imperial ruler. And you know, our president isn't called your excellency or your supremeness. In other countries, they are. And our American system is about pulling down disgusting leaders and not treating them with respect when they don't treat us with respect. So you've done your sacrament, your thing you enjoy so much. That's your free speech. What else happened there at the event?
Well, actually, I didn't even do it. They were planned. In other words, the it was packed with police for some reason, unlike any other time. It was packed with police, so they were ready to do something, I think, to me. And they were expecting me to do the full thing, including the raspberry at the end of it.
Yes, you told us about that.
Yeah, but I did not do that. I just did the mild version that I just recently did for you. And that still, he pretended as if I'd done the raspberry, and he blew up and he called the police over. So it was just his overreaction. You know, I mean, he's obviously out of control. And,
yeah, but what about this issue of you being banned from the imperial court for 1 year?
That's what the security guard came up to me afterwards and said, they've got a rule that if you cross this one barrier, the mayor made a point that I forget what the letter thing was, but they made some technical thing where they said I was disturbing things.
Live from Austin, Texas, broadcasting worldwide, it's Alex Jones.
Our special report, Ron Paul 2012, close to an hour-long special report, is posted right now at prisonplanet.tv, and it is a foreshadowing of the weeknight TV show that kicks off next Thursday, September 1st, 7 p.m., and from that point into the future, probably many years, if civilization doesn't completely collapse or if the First Amendment isn't completely annihilated and the internet kill switch isn't implemented, then it is a new mainstay. So mark your calendars, 7 p.m. Central, 8 p.m. Eastern, InfoWars Nightly News, where all the key intel of the day, key guest, hard-hitting information, condensed down, focused, tailor-designed with the key ingredient, truth, for you to be able to carry the ball and get it out to everyone you know. InfoWars Nightly News. And you, the PrisonPlanet.tv members, have underwritten the work we're doing. And I can just say that we have put together a wonderful crew of great people, our old crew, the new folks we've hired. And I'm very, very excited and blessed and thankful to be here. Now, we're going to Max Keiser to break down the big developments in the economy. He's calling it countdown to meltdown as we see bank failures and collapses going on all over the world. And Warren Buffett and the globalists trying to prop up Bank of America. Bernanke declaring there's not going to be QE3 while he goes ahead with QE3 type programs. We're going to be talking to Max here in just a moment. But finishing up with Austin activist, and I'm going to be honest, I've met Ronnie Reefer Seed a couple times. Nice guy, but he is annoying. And I'm annoying to some as well, okay? And it is obnoxious people that get things done. And he's branding that term, and so people listen to him, and he's trying to become an Austin-type character like Leslie, but in a better way. And I think that's fine. My only issue is that I just was trying to get him to talk about what happened that we didn't see on the camera, and reportedly the mayor throwing other people out. I'm told John Bush was. You can confirm that. Not one of the guys with TAG, what Texans for accountable government. And just the incredible arrogance, because they've already basically made it next to impossible to try to speak at council. Got to sign up a week before, or if you do get signed up for an agenda, they'll try to restrict you. They're very arrogant and haughty and a very nasty globalist, carbon-taxing city council that Austinites should get politically involved and defeat these scum. We need patriots here, not mainline liberals or mainline conservatives. But, Ronnie, what else happened? Because this is part of a larger, dangerous trend of shutting down lemonade stands, banning cameras at town halls, arresting people that speak in court site. I mean, who cares if what you say is a perseveration and beginning to enter the realm of a Tourettesian event? I'm the same way. So I'm not knocking you here. We're both annoying creatures. And I'm sure you're about to repeat the word over and over again, the term. But tell us what else happened there.
No, I won't hit you over the head with it. I really try not to be obnoxious. I try to be articulate. And one thing I have to say, though, that you're leaving out of my whole story is that I'm trying to help save our troops. Literally, I survived a traumatic brain injury similar to what our troops are coming home with, better than some, worse than others. And my main chemical that put me over the edge and back into the real world, ironically, was tetrahydrocannabinol. Somehow I convinced somebody to bring a joint to the hospital. I smoked it, and the next day my memory came back. I'm a new person. I've been trying to spread the news about this medicinal, actual, miraculous-giving medicinal marijuana. It gave me my life back, and that's why I'm so devoted.
I never even knew that. I knew that you were a hemp activist, and I support that. I support freedom across the board, and I support states' rights. So that is wonderful news, Ronnie. We're about to go to Max Kaiser, who's kind enough to join us on short notice here for a segment or so via Skype from Paris with some very important news. So finish up with any other information that happened at the city council and where you're going from here, because I hear legal actions are being prepared.
That's right. I've got some great friends, and we're moving forward. But they shut down, basically. I was thrown out of there. I was literally escorted out of the building, and the cops watched me get in my car to leave. But the people who were there, stayed there, they were still harassed. They weren't allowed to speak, and that's a completely new rule that the mayor dreamed up, that citizens can only, like, the agenda was 115 items. We were only allowed to speak on three of 115 items. Some wacky rule he decided to come up with, and those lockstep
That's saying that even if the issue was, you know, dealing with demolishing your house, if you didn't sign up a week before, you can't speak, and if they're talking about three items that concern you, or four items, sorry, you can't talk about the fourth item. This is a council out of control. They're out of control all over the country. And as this develops and unfolds, Ronnie Reefer-C will continue to check in with you, okay? Thank you so much. In fact, I'm going to put you on hold and try to give you an email or something so you can stay in contact. I know Jaron asked me to give you his email. I'm joking. You're awesome. Jaron gets all these thousands of emails. He's like, how do I keep track of these? But Ronnie, we love you. You're a great guy. And I was saying that as a compliment. You've got to be the squeaky wheel to get the grease, and you certainly have gotten under their skin. A very articulate, smart guy when he's not repeating the Ronnie Reefer-C thing over and over again. But hey, that's how you brand something to get people to pay attention to you. So I think he's a great guy, and we appreciate you. Okay, shifting gears. Max Kaiser of the Kaiser Report on RT, and of course, the On the Edge on Press TV, and radio host, you name it, joins us via video Skype from Paris. And I wanted to get him on because we've got these reports here. Bernanke promises no new steps to boost economy. Bernanke proposes no new steps to boost economy, but hence Congress should help with a new stimulus, I guess, given the special interest. But according to Dr. Roberts and others we've talked to, they're still really engaged in QE3 by stealth, still having the private Federal Reserve buy the Treasury bonds. Max Keiser, what's really happening here?
Well, first of all, can you hear me? I have my headphones in. Can you
yes,
hear me?
Yes, sir. Okay? I can hear you. Very nice headphones.
Okay. The one of the interesting points that he made was that he was going to extend next month's Federal Open Market Committee for 2 days, and they're going to introduce and talk about special tools or new tools to keep quantitative easing going. And the fact that he's not introducing quantitative easing 3, as you point out, the market is still not suffering in terms of where the bond prices are. Bond prices are still being held up. So clearly somebody's doing the buying, and that somebody is the federal government. And so I think what they're doing is they're waiting to back end some big surprises in next month's meeting, which would be the September Federal Open Market Committee meeting. But this is some of the tools that they could be used. I think we're seeing what's happening in countries like Switzerland, which is now charging people to keep money in banks in Switzerland. That's a negative interest rate. And I think this is part of the toolbox that they're going to introduce. So when you have $100,000 at the bank, or even $10,000 or $1,000 at the bank, they'll charge you 1% or 2% as a cost. Remember, only a couple of years ago, you might get 1% or 2% in interest. Now they'll charge you 1% or 2% to store your money. The theory being that this will encourage people to take their money out of the bank and spend it on stocks or spend it on consumer items to get the economy going. And that's one of the so-called special tools that I think we're going to see next month.
Now, in your email this morning, when we contacted you and asked you to come on, you fired back with basically saying banks are getting ready to melt down all over the world, and you listed some countries, mainly in Europe, and then you said 1-2-3 meltdown. So I guess this little segment could be called 1-2-3 meltdown, Max. What does 1-2-3 meltdown mean?
Okay, well, starting in 2000, and then, of course, 2008, we had the collapse of Lehman Brothers and Bear Stearns, and everyone became aware of this global financial crisis. We've been playing a global game of pass the grenade, and the grenade is $50 trillion in debt. And various countries are playing this game of pass the grenade. And if you look at the Financial Times, you'll see this being played out every single day. So in Greece, they announced that Finland is not happy with the collateral that they're getting in exchange for debt forgiveness in that country. So now the ECB is coming in to guarantee more backstop on the Greek economy collapsing. So they're trying to pass the grenade. In France, as I spoke to you on the last time I was on your show, Societe Generale, major bank here in France, technically insolvent, the biggest player and the biggest bailout recipient after the AIG collapse in 2008. They're on a tinderbox. They are in the process of needing some major bailout. They're about to go belly up. And of course, Bank of America here in the United States. A week ago, they said, we don't need capital. But then Warren Buffett said, well, I know you don't need capital, but here's $5 billion anyway. And by the way, I'm going to charge you 7% on that money, even though you could get it same deal from the Feds for a quarter of 1%. And you also, they're selling their big stake in China Construction Bank today to raise capital as desperately as they possibly can, because Bank of America, the second biggest bank in America, is insolvent. So is Societe Generale. So are the banks in Greece. So this game of global pass the financial grenade is speeding up. The stakes are getting higher. And we see it happening in live now, in real time, with news coming out. And as a result, Alex, the markets themselves, you see these enormous swings in volatility. The stock market up and down 400 or 500 points. Price of gold up and down 2 or 3 percentage points in a day. Because the markets themselves are reflecting this unfolding chaos, this unfolding meltdown, banking meltdown. And Bernanke, of course, without being able to offer any leadership whatsoever, he's simply kicking the can down the road and saying, well, next month we'll get to it with special tools that we'll pull out of our magic bag of tricks next month. In the meantime, we're just going to continue to buy these debts and the shadow banking system. We're going to encourage, we're going to increase the debts in the U.S., which is only making the situation much, much worse.
That's right. So when the chickens do fully come home to roost, it'll be much, much worse, as Ron Paul and many other people have broken down. And now you call it pass the grenade or musical chairs. And the person that gets left standing when the music stops basically burst into flame. You could also liken it to a revolver with, say, 15 chambers in it. And there's a round in one of them. And so they spin the cylinder and they hand it to Europe, then back to the U.S., and then to England, and then they hand it to Asia, and then they hand it to Latin America. So they're trying to pass the grenade around, but even as they're passing it around, Max, we see the blood running out of the economy worldwide. So I go back to this. As we get closer and closer to this event horizon that Dr. Roberts was talking about yesterday, where there is no point of return, he believes there is a point of return if they reverse these policies, but they're not reversing them because it's command destruction. They are wrecking the global economy, massing all the assets in their hands. Then they'll blow out the dummy banks later. The elites will be left holding all the quote resources, and then we'll be their debt slaves. So what's the time frame here, Max, on how you see all of this basically playing out?
Well, what's being sacrificed in the interim, what's being sacrificed today, our various countries' sovereignty. So in the case of Greece, they've lost their sovereignty. In the case of Ireland, they've lost their sovereignty. Iceland maintained their sovereignty only by kicking the bankers out and prosecuting them and chasing them into London where they're hiding out and by letting their economy collapse. But they're the exception. So, but very, these countries are in turn losing their sovereignty. And the way that it happens is that because there's no leadership from a Bernanke or an Obama, they keep deferring to the Bank of International Settlements or the World Bank or the International Monetary Fund, which, of course, are global institutions. So Bernanke and Obama are swapping America's sovereignty to avoid having to deal with this problem today. And that's happening right now. So the timeline is today. America is in the process of losing its sovereignty today because the financial decisions that will affect America's future are being discussed in the hallways, in the conference rooms, in Brussels, in Switzerland, in Europe, and around the world. They're not being discussed by Obama. Obama has essentially abdicated his role as president of the United States. He's now just a functionary waiting for instructions from these global bankers who have taken on the responsibility to sort out this debt problem. And the way that they sort out the debt problem is to increase the debt. And that's the only thing they know how to do. And as a result, it's only making the situation much worse. Now, just as a way to illustrate this, Alex, I thought this might be interesting. As I was waiting to get on the show here, I posted on my website two charts, the U.S. government 10-year bond chart, both the price and the yield, to just give you a graphic illustration of the history of America's demise. Because if you go back to 1980, when the 10-year interest rate was 15.5%, that was the beginning of the Reagan revolution and the neoliberal revolution and the Wall Street ascent to take over the economy. Since that 1980 period when interest rates on the 10-year bond were 15.5%, they are now at 2%. And that is the history of America going into the debt market to finance its growth. At some point during the past 40 years, somebody should have stepped in and stopped that 10-year interest rate from going to 2%. Because 2% is like, if you have to think of it like an EKG machine at the hospital, you know, when it gets down to the point where it's not moving anymore, the patient is dead.
Max, let me stop you. We're going to, for PrisonPlanet.tv viewers, radio listeners can go to MaxKaiser.com and see these graphs. But for live viewers right now that are watching us on TV, we're going to put the graphs up on screen. So describe what you're talking about here.
Right. This is just a very simple graph of the price of a U.S. government 10-year treasury bond going back to 1980, when the yield or the amount of money you would get on that bond, if you were a saver and you bought a 10-year treasury bond, you would be getting 15.5% on your money. If you're a saver, if you had a pension account, that's what you got on your money. And as you see, the history up until today is the slide down to 2%. And last week, it got down to below 2%. Underneath that chart, you see the price of the bond markets that have gone up and up and up. Now, the reason why it's important to understand this, is when people talk about extend and pretend in dealing with the debt problems, what they mean is that as long as interest rates are going down, as you see in the top chart, they can keep adding to the debt load and making it the debt load bigger and bigger, because the interest cost on that debt, as you see that in chart number one, that keeps getting cheaper and cheaper. And at the bottom, you see the price of the bonds getting higher and higher. And that's the dynamic. That is the essential underlying dynamic driving 40 years of financial history in America, and how America went from having $500 billion of debt under Reagan to having 14 to 15 to 16 trillion in debt, with stated with another 50 trillion off the books. That's how they did it. They used artificially cheap interest rates. And that's what quantitative easing is, Alex. It's about the government keeping interest rates artificially cheap to support this bond market. And that's the dynamic.
Absolutely. When we come back, I want to get to the central issue. It's horrible for us, but it's good for the central banks. They institute the crisis. They pose as the saviors. They take the system completely over and then rape us that much harder. How do we get out of it? Simple. The mega banks set up the Council on Foreign Relations and other corporate groups to influence peddle and set up vertically integrated pyramidal power structures in every Western country. They lobbied and over time took control of our militaries. And now, totally ruthless mega banks, six of them, and the private families that own and control them are establishing absolute domination over this country and the rest of the world. They are funding Al-Qaeda rebels openly, now admitting that the West started the whole thing in Libya. It was all staged, an overthrow, unbelievable humanitarian disaster. They are now openly announcing in the last 2 years the solution to the economic crisis they created, that they're admittedly the authors of it, the derivatives fraud, wrecking a once powerful sovereign nation state, the United States, and many other sovereign states, taking us from the greatest creditor to the greatest debtor. They are now openly announcing new private banks of the world. Look what Max has talked about, the EU. They call it Rise of the Fourth Reich, a financial dictatorship. Now we have the super Congress in control of our financial system, not the rest of Congress. Max, is our weakness that some of us have a blind spot, that when real tyranny actually takes over, because it's done in a bureaucratic way and, you know, not some guy in a military outfit strutting around with a beret on, that people can't recognize it? Because they're going to give us no quarter. They are going to throttle us back into the Stone Age and wreck everything. I don't think people understand that they're not playing games. They're going to totally wreck everything, because that's their financial terrorist operation.
Well, I think you can learn a lot from just focusing on prices and how prices represent themselves in the economy and how prices are trending in the economy. So when you ask, why are people acquiescent to this soft stealth coup of the economy? It's because for those same 40 years we just talked about, the prices of stuff like food and energy have been going down, and America was able to outsource its labor to China, which meant that you could buy clothes for prices that were cheaper. The prices of electronics keeps going down. So it's been accomplished by delivering to Americans cheaper prices. They go to Walmart, they buy stuff, and they get a lot, for a dollar, because it's so cheap, because of all this really geopolitical domination that goes on in countries.
But
where
that's in the early phase, where the crack dealer goes and gives the 10 and 11-year-old some free crack. Now we're basically zombie crack whores wandering around with pus coming out of our eyes.
Right. Now prices are starting to go up. So, and this is what's causing the crisis. And, that 10-year government bond chart that now shows getting 2% on a 10-year bond, well, we know that inflation is running 4%, 5%, 6%. So that means that you're losing money now every single year. So the magic of the post-Reagan revolution is finished and it's running in reverse, and people's purchasing power is collapsing. And once the price of food, there's a magic formula. Once the price of food gets to be 40% of your weekly budget, you start to see revolutions. It got to that point in Tunis, and we saw a revolution. It got to that point in Egypt, and we saw a revolution. Once it gets to 40% of your budget, the price of food, and it gets to 40%, it tends to create a revolutionary type of situations. And in America, the price of food is now creeping up to being a major part of people's weekly spend. Their wages are going down, but the price of food and energy is going up. And this is what's causing this dynamic.
So Max, now, do five more minutes with us, because I want to see where this dynamic's leading us. Then your calls, Lou Rockwell, Bob Chapman, and more.
Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
All right, your phone calls are coming up in the next two segments, and I've got an interview with Lou Rockwell coming up, former campaign manager Ron Paul, head of the Von Mises Institute, LouRockwell.com, obviously. That's coming up. Then Bob Chapman, and phones will continue to be open with him. A bunch of other news we haven't gotten to. That's coming up as well. More on that hurricane. We're going to break that down. If it turns out like New Orleans and some city gets destroyed, you know, they're coming for the guns. They're not bringing hot blankets. They're coming to your house to take your guns. Let's go back to Max Keiser. So, Max, the system knew this was coming. As soon as they got rid of Glass-Steagall, with similar laws in Europe the last 15 years, they began to set up domestic police state grids. And then 5 years ago, again 3 years ago, the British Ministry of Defense said, we know there's a collapse of society coming. Well, yeah, because the banks that run things engineered this. So clearly they're creating it. Instead of getting in trouble for the Ponzi scheme, they become world rulers. So we just stay tied to them like a bowling ball, taking us to the bottom of the ocean, a 10,000-pound bowling ball. So we're getting to this food ratio situation. So where do you see this going? How do you see this ending?
Well, we're in the end game now, because you mentioned Glass-Steagall, and I would also add the Commodity Futures Modernization Act to that. There were ways to increase the debt load. That's what made it possible to increase the debt load to these astronomical levels. But now we've hit debt saturation. And as you point out, it is a Ponzi scheme. And the Ponzi scheme only works to the extent that you have new Ponzis coming in to feed the base of the scheme. But those Ponzis aren't there anymore, because people now are taking food stamps. 50 million, I think, are on food stamps in the U.S. And this is not a Ponzi scheme. This is draining the pool of liquidity in ways that make the Ponzi scheme collapse. So it's collapsing in real time. It's just the way I described earlier is that it's collapsing in all over the world in countries at different speeds. And as it falls, you know, when you fall off a cliff, if you hit a branch on the way down, it momentarily blocks you. And then you hit the branch, and then you continue to fall. So as these countries are all falling right now, they're falling at different rates of speed, and they're encountering different problems as they're falling. But they're all falling now. The U.S. dollar is the world reserve currency. It's still holding up relatively to some of these other currencies, however, not against the Swiss franc or not against gold and silver. Gold and silver, obviously, are becoming the de facto global currency. The only currency people around the world can trust now is gold and silver. And so they're getting rid of all their paper money, and they're going into gold and silver, even though the people who manage those exchanges are raising margin rates continuously, trying to stop people from buying gold and silver. But here's the funny thing about that, is that at some point, all they're doing is they're forcing all the non-leveraged players out of the gold and silver market, which means that the only people left are the people who have 100% paid for the gold and silver, and you have therefore created a de facto global gold standard.
So short term, they're trying to block the general public from getting into gold and silver by raising the margins, hoping it drives it down. But over time, that begins to block their naked shorting that they've also been using to block it. And so it's kicking a lot of speculation out and turning it into a stable currency.
Correct. That's exactly right. They're squeezing out the speculation which has a momentary sell-offs as the result, but the price is still in an uptrend, and the result is that you've got all cash owners. It becomes a de facto global gold standard.
Incredible. And then they play these games where they'll drive it down $100 in a day, and then it shoots back up $150 the next, and we see that happening today. And people look at one-month graphs and say, well, it was up, and then it was down. Look at a year graph, folks. Look at a 10-year graph. It is scary how much gold's going up, because that signifies they are butchering these currencies worldwide and all these institutions grabbing their gold. That was my last question, Max, and then I promise we'll let you go. But I want to get your view, because I didn't ask you this, on Hugo Chavez seizing his gold back from England and other reserves around the world. Why is that happening, and where do you see gold going? Two more minutes with Max Keiser at MaxKeiser.com. On the other side, I'm Alex Jones.
Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
Lou Rockwell, former Ron Paul campaign manager and chief of staff, going to be joining us to talk about the incredible Time Magazine five-page spread to convince America Ron Paul can't win. Ryder states Paul isn't really running for president, at least not entirely. So they're still running that hoax. It blew up in their face a week and a half ago, but they're back with it again, and they're starting the Rand Paul attack stuff, that they worship Buddhas and maybe reptoids. It's so ridiculous, and they're scared, folks. He is in every poll the closest to beating Obama. In some polls, he beats him. In other polls, he's 1 point behind him. Perry is 3 points behind him. Mitt Romney's 5 to 6 points. That was in Gallup yesterday. In some polls, Ron Paul is number one in scientific polls. In others, he's number two or number three. If they gave him proper attention, as Pew Research admitted, he gets the least amount of coverage of any Republican candidate, and it's almost all negative by the so-called mainstream media that only reports on itself. They play this game like we don't exist, when Infowars.com is roughly three times the size of MSNBC's website. These people are legends in their own mind. Fox, to a great extent, dwarfs these guys, but they're legends in their own mind. The alternative media, individual personalities are towering. But in the aggregate, we dwarf them. It's like the Earth saying it's bigger than Jupiter, when Jupiter's hundreds of times the size of the Earth, or Pluto saying it's bigger than the Sun. And I think that's great, though, Max, because I briefly want to get into the question I brought up of Hugo Chavez running off of his gold, University of Texas buying billions in gold, all these other institutions going in and grabbing it and finishing up there. But what do you make of just the hysterical demonization and attacks on Ron Paul, while at the same time saying he doesn't exist?
Well, he represents the antidote to having banks run and destroy your country, because clearly he has a grounding in a school of economics that is the complete opposite of the school of economics that has destroyed the U.S. economy. And Lou Rockwell can talk all about that, whether the Austrian school of economics favors a return to hard money and real accountability. And so clearly, if you're in the banking business or in the mainstream media business, whether your business is the mainstream media, which is counterfeiting lies all day, or a big bank that counterfeits Federal Reserve notes all day, you're not going to want Ron Paul in office, because he's going to shut you down. So they're going to use their power of their counterfeiting of lies to flood the propaganda outlets. And they're going to use the power of propaganda of counterfeiting Federal Reserve notes to debase the currency, to fund the propaganda and the wars and everything else. So he is the anecdote. He's the guy you got to go to now to clean up this mess. And it doesn't surprise me that the mainstream media is scared to death of him.
Don't they run the danger, though? And there's a lot of evidence showing that the hoax is failing. Daily Show, I put it more succinctly, I think, than we even have, illustrating that they're following a talking point. All the mainline media, liberal, conservative, you name it, even the so-called ABC News type straight-faced stuff, they try to act like they're impartial. They act like He is Von Helsing, and they are Count Dracula. I mean, they are hissing at him. And this is just another reminder of just how duplicitous and treacherous and traitorous these people are. But then another angle, they got Rick Perry coming out and going up in Gallup 10 points in 1 week after saying, I'm like Ron Paul. I say the Federal Reserve might be treasonous or treacherous. And so just the fact that he did that, he turbo surged into the lead in most of the polls ahead of Ron Paul by acting like Ron Paul. I mean, this really shows that liberty is rising and people are starting to really get it, Max.
Well, that's the risk you take if you are so paranoid about having a legitimate economist in the president of the United States office that you are going to risk putting up a straw man, a front man like Rick Perry, who is clearly a psychopath. You are endangering the country in ways that you have to go to and study that film, The Manchurian Candidate. Remember that film and that novel, which was it was banned. The Manchurian Candidate was banned in America for years. It starred Frank Sinatra and Angela Lansbury. And they talk about this candidate that was made president of the United States by through brainwashing. And this is what a Rick Perry is. He's the Manchurian candidate from the banking, you know, Bankistan, who's there to represent the interests of the counterfeiters. And that's a real risk when you have somebody who's as mentally depraved and brainwashed as that in the White House. Now, you mentioned Venezuela and Hugo Chavez. He wants his 200 tons of gold back. I look historically back to a very similar incident in the mid-60s when Charles de Gaulle of France demanded France's gold because for the same reason, that the U.S. was debasing the global currency and using it, the world reserve currency, and abusing it. And shortly after de Gaulle took his gold back from the New York Federal Reserve Bank and put it back into France, gold went from $35 an ounce to $800 an ounce. So if this is the beginning of a similar type move, you're talking about gold making a move from $1,800 an ounce to over $40,000 an ounce, which some are talking about as a possibility if the system gets so cracked and so abused that a monetization of gold by the U.S. or in the Eurozone is necessary to sort this all out. They would have to do so against the basket of $100 trillion worth of fiat money. And to square the circle, you come up with a $35,000, $40,000 an ounce price for gold, which is the possibility.
And by the way, they would probably, I want your view on this in conclusion, Max, we appreciate your time today, Max, of course, the Max Kaiser Report on RT. Max, they can ban gold for private ownership again like they did. And people say, well, then why have it? Well, just don't turn it in. These are a bunch of crooks. I mean, if the government told you to go throw your kid off a cliff like the Aztecs would do or to report to a Nazi gas chamber, I mean, it's time to say no. But even if they try to restrict it here domestically, the whole world's getting into gold now. It's not going to work.
It's like the record companies trying to stop P2P file swapping when Napster came around. They didn't work. Eventually, they had to totally change their business model to adapt to the new reality. The fact that the gold is now owned around the world, it's owned electronically, it's owned in ways that were never imagined up until a few years ago, means that there's going to be virtually impossible to have a confiscation scheme as they did back in the 1930s. So they're going to have to adapt to the new reality, not the other way around.
Max Kaiser, thank you for spending so much time with us. We'll talk to you again soon.
Look forward to hearing the Lou Rockwell interview. That guy rocks.
Oh, he's awesome. That's coming up. And again, that's going to be from last night's TV show that we did, a special report. We're going to be premiering that here to the full radio audience, and the entire interview and more is up at prisonplanet.tv. By the way, I'm really proud of the reports we did last night. We had field reporters out talking to Texans about the power prices going up because of carbon taxes. And reporting on the scene at the Capitol and at a power plant, the globalists shut down here in Austin, part of their squeezing the slaves program. We had another report filed on Libya news package with the Lou Rockwell interview, and I cover a whole spectrum of news and have commentary on Steve Jobs. And this is just the start. We're going to get better and better and better at presenting this information. And it's very exciting because we're reaching hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of millions of people every year, conservatively, just on the internet alone right now, just on YouTube. Imagine all the other sites. I mean, it is huge what we've been able to do together. And all the glory goes to God. I wouldn't even be alive here if it wasn't for that. Okay, there goes Max Kaiser. Let's go to who's up first here. David. No, David's first. I'm still getting used to this new phone system. David in New Jersey, you're on the air. Welcome.
Hello, sir. I want to ask you what or who the six major megabanks are. Could you please name them all live on air?
Sure. I have named them at nauseam. And then they've got subsidiaries, and they're all interconnected. I mean, total, there's like 15. But the big six megabanks are in order here, and you can debate this, is J.P. Morgan, Goldman Sachs, or Bank of America, you could argue, but J.P. Morgan, I was going to do this quick with like numbers and things, but I'll get it wrong. It's like, you know, in my brain, it's like U.S. Code, Title 50, Chapter 32, Subsection 1528, Paragraph B. That's where the government's allowed to test chemicals, biologicals, radiologicals on you. But I can only say it if I say it quick. It's like in memory. I know the six. I'm trying to, like, in the order. Goldman Sachs, J.P. Morgan, Goldman Sachs, Bank of America, Wells Fargo, Citibank, and then you can look at the Bank of England, which they claim is government, but it's really private, and some of the connections. Then you've got the big French bank. You've got the German group of banks, and there's a whole list of those. They're all basically owned by the same people. But there are the six big mega banks for you right there, sir.
Thank you very much.
Is that it?
Yeah, I would say so, yes. Thank you.
All right, thank you. You know, we should do a whole special report on them and show the numbers and show graphs. In fact, I've got a booklet around here where I'm writing show package ideas. See, the great part is I'm going to be able to every night have condensed, focused pieces where I'm not just going in 80 different directions, which is great for talk radio. You know, very popular radio show growing, but this news show, that's why I'm so excited, prisonplanet.tv. Okay, when we come back, Clay, James, Mike, Keith, and others, we're going to get to you, and then I'm going to get to this Lou Rockwell interview. And again, Lou Rockwell is such a great guy. I mean, he's for 30 years been out there fighting tyranny. And when it comes to libertarians, he is probably the second most prominent guy out there. And that's such an asset for those that love freedom and that we have a brain trust of these great people out there. So that's coming up. By the way, it looks like Ron Paul is going to be on next week. I can't wait for that interview. We'll be right back. Stay with us. More on the other side. GCNLive.com is the news website. Yeah, one of the crew went and looked up biggest banks, and CNN calls it the world's most admired companies. And it basically does list in pretty much the same order, but they don't mention Goldman Sachs. I guess they're not very admired. But Bank of America, J.P. Morgan Chase, Credit Suisse Group, Wells Fargo, Deutsche Bank, ING, the other huge, BNP. I mean, it's I say six megabanks. You could say 15 megabanks. You could say 20 megabanks, but it's a lot of the experts I've talked to over the years say, it's really six. And they're all interconnected. I mean, it's like Warren Buffett's involved in three or four of them. Big time in Wells Fargo. Big time Bank of America. It's all interconnected. And it used to be more. You know, they've imploded a few of them and consolidated it. Let's go ahead and go back to your calls. And let's speak to Clay in Texas, listening on 90.1 FM. Welcome, Clay.
Thanks for having me on, Alex. I love your show, and it was great meeting you at the Capitol about a month ago at the TSA protest.
Absolutely.
Well, should I just go ahead and tell what happened?
Tell what happened. I didn't screen your call. I don't know what's going on.
Okay. Well, it really started last week on August 18th. And we've been getting a group together and going down to City Hall and finding items we find objectionable and then just going up there and giving our public input. And only really on 7-8% of all the items they consider, like Ronnie was saying.
Can you imagine the evil of citizens actually going to a government building where citizens are always supposed to, I mean, in the old-fashioned times, everybody in the town got in there, and then they would vote, and then they'd have some town officers that would handle, you know, their orders. I mean, you went and tried to speak in a communication as state law states. You, man, what type of, next you're going to say you wanted to have a garden. You people. So well, what happened? What happened?
Well, what happened was August 18th, me and Ronnie were down there, and we had both signed up for about 15 items, and I had confirmed with the city clerk that I was signed up for those items. Then it's 1 minute before the meeting starts, and they start saying, no, you can't sign up for more than, you can't talk on more than three items, period.
Well, what you do is you organize everybody now to sue them over this, and at the same time, while the suit's going, you have like 50 people go down and all sign up for three because they don't want to hear from you. They want to give millions to Formula One. They want to take more people's property. They want to shut down more power plants. They want to put carbon taxes in. They want to rob us seven ways to Sunday. And it's up to Austinites and other people around the country to start seeing these globalist city councils for what they are, pimps of the New World Order.
Yes, sir. And I'll say that yesterday I was denied my First Amendment rights to speak on Barton Springs pool issue, also the tasers issue. APD, they just authorized, I think unanimously, 6-0 with one council member gone, $600,000 for tasers. So I'll do whatever is necessary. I'll file a lawsuit. I'll run for council myself.
You're not allowed to speak out about the fact that people are dying all the time and they've upped the power of the tasers. You think in land of the slave, home of the coward, that you, George Washington would be incensed. George Washington fought so that you not be allowed to speak at a city council meeting and so you could be tasered to death. George Washington fought so Amish would be arrested for milk. He fought so you couldn't sell lemonade on the street corner. He fought so you can't have a garden. You people are the ones destroying America. And Ron Paul is too. Goldman Sachs is good. They made the grass come up this morning. They made the sunshine. They gave us oxygen. And thank goodness they're going to tax carbon dioxide. You people, what have you become? Do you want to apologize right now, Clay, to the world? For the fact that you don't love Lee Leffingwell prancing around running his ops. You scum American. You're there to lick his boots. I bet you don't like the CIA being in the Threat Fusion Center violating federal law here in Austin. Or the face scanning cameras. Or all the narcotics that are brought into town. You people.
No, sir. And that's, you know, you're taking Leffingwell's line, and I think he owes us an apology.
No.
I think Leffingwell should apologize to each and one of us personally because he's restricting me. I said, look, how can I help?
I'm you don't have a name like Trendywell. Dude, that guy's trendy. He waddles around and lives in Tarrytown. You're not trendy.
This is something out of a movie almost. The footage I got yesterday of Ronnie, which is not posted yet, we need to edit it tonight. I'm waiting for this guy to get out of class so we can do it. And it's going to be major. It is an amazing, it's on a HD camera. And
so what happened? Tell us what happened.
Well, Ronnie just said his name, and the mayor went crazy. He blew a fuse. He looked like a madman up there.
He's a good man. He's a good man.
Out, and it was all on film. We got John Bush. Random people were standing up, Alex, and saying, you can't do that. You can't do that. People, we weren't even.
And I heard they were thrown out as well.
Yeah, they were threatened with getting thrown out, all sorts of things.
Well,
Alex.
I mean, look, extremist. The Federal Reserve rules us. We ought to thank them and ban all freedom. How dare you?
We are on the march. The Empire is on the run. Alex Jones and the GCN Radio Network.
There is a lot of incredible news at Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. I can't believe the information we break. Norwegian police have confirmed a drill identical to Breivik's attack. We first reported on this back at the time when the tragic shootings happened. But now it's been confirmed by the police. Very powerful article by Kurt Nemo. Also, Time Magazine pins 5-page spread to convince America Ron Paul can't win. We're going to be talking to Lou Rockwell here in just a moment about that. Also, I want to get a little bit into the hurricane set to hit the East Coast and go right through New York and other areas. Got to pray for all those folks in those areas and hope that it weakens. Also, Gaddafi's desperate bid to save regime revealed secret documents to tell clandestine lobbying of NATO and even Obama following fear of full-scale U.S. invasion. And it turns out he'd been given information through his congressional sources and others that they were looking at a U.S.-NATO backed invasion. This is from Gaddafi's camp, either in September or October. That was the exact info I got from Fort Hood, Fort Benning, Georgia, and other sources. In fact, I've asked Watson to do a flashback to that to point that out to listeners. Another thing that we accurately broke down, and now they're admitting that 6 months ago, they already had U.S. forces and others there backing the Gaddafi rebels. Okay, let's go ahead and go to our interview with Lou Rockwell, ladies and gentlemen. This is key information dealing with Ron Paul, 2012, the election, and more. Here to give us the inside scoop on all things Ron Paul and how America can get behind this true constitutionalist is the editor-in-chief of LouRockwell.com, none other than Lou Rockwell, who also, of course, served as Ron Paul's chief of staff. So it doesn't get any better than Ron Paul, but if there has to be a second brightest spot in the universe, it's Lou Rockwell. Lou, thank you for joining us tonight.
Alex, great to be with you.
So much is happening out of the gates. Can Ron Paul win?
Yeah, Ron Paul can win. And in fact, the fear that the media is exhibiting by first trying to put the blackout on him, and then, of course, demonizing him when they're not blacking him out, shows that they are very afraid. He's talking about issues that are resonating with the American people as never before, issues that threaten the establishment, everything from the Pentagon to the CIA to the Federal Reserve to the bankocracy and all the rest of the power elite in Washington. They're being threatened. They're worried, and they wouldn't be paying, you know, they wouldn't be saying anything about Ron Paul. Rush Limbaugh, Hannity, Bill O'Reilly, all the rest of these people would not be denouncing him if he didn't threaten the apparatus that they're part of. So he can win, and as you say, he's moving up in the polls. He's moving up slowly, but he's moving up organically. He's getting more and more people, young people especially, but people of all ages in all different states, not only in this country, I might add, but around the world. People are Ron Paulians in every country. So this is an international movement. It bodes so well for the American future as we face, of course, terrible economic and other kinds of troubles. But this is the bright spot in America today is the Ron Paul movement.
And, of course, I was being somewhat sarcastic and devil's advocate when I said, can he win? I mean, in every poll, he's in the top three candidates. New Gallup poll out today shows him in third place. Some have shown him in second place, others in first place. And it's this mantra of telling the public he can't win. I'm sure you saw that Pure Research piece that Pew put out last week showing that, indeed, Ron Paul has gotten less coverage than any other candidate, and most of the coverage has been negative. Well, that right there is an endorsement. If Limbaugh is saying he'll destroy the Republican Party, I saw what you wrote. Well, you know, good if it destroys the official, you know, Republican Party.
Yeah, that'd be good news.
Yeah. So that's the proof right there that the whole establishment is coming after him. I mean, that's the proof right there that he's the man for the job, not just his long record of being a constitutionalist.
Well, as we know, George H.W. Bush refers to Rush Limbaugh as our boy. And indeed he is. You know, he is part of that. The Bush establishment, country club, Republican apparatus. But the more that people get to know Ron, I believe, by the way, the media stuff is backfiring on them because people who are paying attention realize just how unfair this is, and they want to know, well, why is he being targeted? So once they look at Ron, once they see his YouTubes, of course, if they saw him in person, when they read his articles, read his books, this is the most learned guy running for president in a very, very long time. Maybe we have to go back to Jefferson. I mean, he's so well-read. He understands economics. He understands history. He understands everything about what's going on in this country. He's so much smarter than Rick Perry, Bachman, Romney, the rest of these guys. He just is intellectually head and shoulders above them, of course, in character, too. And as people get to know him, they flock to him. So it's quite an extraordinary moment in American history, and I think it's why we have to be fundamentally optimistic. Because so many young people have just had it with the system. They know there's a problem. I just saw a wonderful YouTube put together by some kids last night where it's people all over the country saying, you know there's a problem. We don't believe what the government is saying. We don't believe what the media is saying. Only Ron Paul is telling us the truth. And so, you know, we need a change. We need some hope, not like Obama. We don't need any more bankocracy, the two-party bankocracy of the Democrats and the Republicans. We need something different. So Ron Paul is, again, he's scaring the pants off the establishment, and that's very good news.
Well, I agree with you, and just about a week ago, The Daily Show came out and really pointed out that there was an open campaign to ignore Ron Paul, or if they were forced to cover him, say, well, he can't win. And since the dam is broken on the attempt to cover up Ron Paul, and since it backfired, I now see them shifting gears. And I fear that we're going to see Aqua Buddha attempts. We're going to hear that Ron Paul assassinated Lincoln. We're going to hear that he blew up the Lusitania, that he started, well, that he crucified Christ. But I saw that, again, backfire when they tried it on Rand. What's your political instinct, Lou, on the next way they're going to try to go after Ron Paul, and will it be effective?
I don't think it'll be effective. Of course, it's the old Gandhi line about, you know, first they ignore you, then they attack you, then you win. So this is just going along with what they usually do. But as we know from polls, as we know from everybody that we talk to ourselves, and you're especially in touch with so many people, nobody trusts the mainstream media. Nobody believes them. The new media, like the Alex Jones Show, people have trust in, but nobody trusts NBC, CBS, ABC, Fox, and the rest of these. At least not most Americans don't. So when they see these people going after somebody, it makes them ask, what's right about him? So again, all you have to do is direct people to Ron, to his YouTubes, his writings, his website, and the websites about him, and people love him. And they have hope, and they no longer feel not that Ron is giving us any soft soap. We know we've got serious economic troubles, very serious economic troubles, and other sorts of troubles ahead. But as Ron explains to us, we can have a way out of it. There is a way out of it. We don't have to have this forever. There is a path to economic growth, to prosperity, to human flourishing. Against all the people who, of course, are against human flourishing, the warmongers, the money counterfeiters, the bankers, and all the rest of the power elite. So they're going to smear him. They're going to libel him. They're going to toss mud at him. But, you know, they talked about Reagan being the Teflon candidate. Actually, Ron Paul's the Teflon candidate, not because the stuff just doesn't stick to him. And it's because when people look at him, I remember in a previous congressional election where his opponent said he's against the drug war. He wants heroin dispensaries at the public schools, at the elementary school, so the kids can take heroin. Well, of course, nobody believes that stuff. They look at Ron Paul. They listen to him. They get a sense of the kind of man he is. Now, you don't get that from any kind of politician, a regular politician. Maybe you just think he's a slippery guy. People listen to Ron Paul, and they think, well, you know, this is a wise man. This is a man who knows. This is a man who's brilliant and who's actually got hope for the future. So I think the campaign is not going to work. Again, it's going to backfire, just like the blackout backfired. More and more Americans, the more they examine Bachman or Perry or Romney or Chris Christie or Palin or any of those other people they're talking about, let alone Jeb Bush. I mean, the other people they're talking about maybe getting in the race, they're all pygmies. They're moral pygmies, they're intellectual pygmies against a very great man, Ron Paul. So,
well, they're undoubtedly political hacks. I mean, they're just complete political fake creatures who constantly flip-flop, and I don't want to dwell too long on this, but Rick Perry, who pledged not to run, of course, broke the pledge, was all about piquing interest in the reluctant hero. He's a guy for forced inoculations, NAFTA superhighways, Al Gore's former chief of staff in Texas. And this now the media is saying is the front runner. And I just say shame on America if you go for another Obama type, another Rick Perry, another packaged plastic Ken doll, if they don't choose Ron Paul. But briefly, your take on Rick Perry and then the fact that Ron Paul is really the man of the hour. He predicted with precision, along with you and others, exactly what would happen with the inflation tax and so much more, and your view on the upcoming death of the dollar.
Well, I think, first of all, as to Rick Perry, there are many things to say about him. To me, the key thing that stands out in my mind is the fact that in Texas he's known as Gardasil Rick. And that's because he took money from the Merck drug company, as did the Republican Party of Texas and all the Republican politicians down there, to force a very dangerous and untested HPV vaccine on every sixth grade girl in public school in Texas. The fact that this man, who, you know, talks about the Obama mandate, the fact that this guy would have used government force and, of course, a huge ripoff for Merck, I mean, hundreds of dollars per shot, these girls had to have multiple shots, causing so many illnesses, happened in England too. The fact that this guy would have used the power of the governorship in return for bribes, maybe they're legal bribes, or they're still bribes, to force this dangerous vaccine on little girls. What a criminal. What a monster. I mean, Rick Perry, I mean, all these politicians, of course, are criminals and monsters, the regular politicians. But Perry really stands out as, it seems to me, a first-class creep, a totalitarian, as you say, the Trans-Texas Highwayman, all the various things he's done. This guy is just, I'm not worried at all about Perry. Because as the word gets out about who he really is, he's going to go nowhere. I don't think Americans are ready for another George W. Bush, and he's another clown like Bush.
But he's trying to become Ron Paul, saying that the Federal Reserve is almost treasonous. Well, no, it's a private offshore corporation. It's looking out for itself. How is that treasonous? Isn't it really treasonous that Congress and others have let them do this to our country? And he's trying to become Ron Paul. And I think it shows how powerful the message of liberty is that you and others and Ron Paul have been real standard bearers for, that now Rick Perry is openly trying to shapeshift into Ron Paul. And if we simply get out the truth about his record and say, no, Ron Paul is the real Ron Paul. He's the real McCoy, not Rick Perry. I mean, that is... job number one, I think, is to expose the Rick Perry hoax.
Well, I think that's right. But, you know, as you say, it is a tribute to Ron that he feels, correctly so, that by denouncing the Federal Reserve and denouncing Ben Bernanke, it's good politics. So this is because, Ron, you know, when I've been interested in the Fed for a very long time, and I can tell you people's eyes would glaze over when you tried to discuss it. Ron Paul made the Fed interesting. He made Americans aware that we're being ripped off by the Federal Reserve and its associated banks. And so that the establishment said, well, Rick Perry really damaged himself when he said that about Bernanke and the Fed. Actually, he didn't, of course. He helped himself. But he is a fake. He's a phony. He's trying to steal Ron Paul's thunder. But I think it's not going to work. Ron Paul is the real deal. And as I can testify myself from having worked for him and having known him for so many years, what you see on the television screen is actually the real guy. I mean, he actually, unlike... other people I've known in politics who are not the same as on the TV screen. Ron Paul's the real deal. And he actually has studied the Federal Reserve. He's read vastly, and he knows everything about the history of the Fed, everything they're doing to the dollar. And they are bringing about, of course, as you pointed out, the death of the dollar. We face, it's a horror, we don't know the timing, and the dollar is going to be strengthened probably by all the continuing troubles that the banks are giving the European countries and destroying the euro. But we're going to see much higher inflation here. It's going to be horrific, probably going to be worse than the 1970s. But again, we don't have to have that permanently. We don't have to have a counterfeiting board in Washington, D.C., ripping off regular people for the benefit of Wall Street and the big banks and the government itself. So we don't have to have all these wars. What are they fighting, six or seven wars and, of course, secret wars and knee-deep in blood all over the world? Other countries resent it. Americans ought to resent it. Ron Paul is talking about really the most important issue, even more important than the money issue, and it's hard to think of anything that is, except the one issue of war and peace. So no more wars. Bring the troops home. Stop the counterfeiting. Cut government spending. It can be done. And I know that people have questioned, well, if Ron Paul were elected, the Congress would never go along with him. But all I can say is if Ron Paul is to be elected and the kind of mandate he would have, all those congressmen who care about being elected more than anything else and being reelected would be asking, Dr. Paul, what do we do?
Absolutely.
The whole country would be in the mood for big changes. I hate to use Roosevelt's phrase, but an actual New Deal, a New Deal for the American people, a New Deal of freedom, a New Deal of prosperity, a Ron Paul New Deal.
Absolutely. And just 15, 20 years ago, he couldn't get one co-sponsor to audit the Fed. It passed the House, as you know, last year. And with Ron Paul as president, they would have a lot of trouble. No army can stop an idea whose time has come, as the French philosopher Victor Hugo said. And after decades of laboring out there in the wilderness, Lou, you and others that deserve so much credit, our time is coming. The liberty is approaching. And even if Ron Paul doesn't win this round, he certainly wins by injecting real issues. And freedom is popular, and we need to legalize freedom, as Ron Paul and as you have said. Lou Rockwell of LouRockwell.com, I'll continue to track all the amazing research and reports you put out, and also the work you do over at the Von Mises Institute that you founded and head up. Lou Rockwell, thank you so much for joining us.
Alex, thank you so much.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, that's just 14 minutes or so of a 45-minute special report. And to be clear, what we're going to be doing in the future is having the 30-minute show Monday through Friday, 7 p.m., starting next Thursday, September 1st. But we're also going to then tag on other extended special reports, documentaries, and a lot more. So if you're not a PrisonPlanet.tv member, now is the time to truly support real frontline media. And my point about Rick Perry and the Federal Reserve on treason, obviously they're an enemy. They're not engaging in treason because they're an outside enemy. It's our government that lets them do this that are the treasonous traitors. The Federal Reserve is an alien enemy, an outside, un-American, larceny. Confirm the Libyan rebels are raping women and children, murdering people en masse. They tried to arrest mainline, big-time, famous French journalist, Thierry Masson, until the Red Cross went and got him released. They were probably going to line him up and kill him. These are some really nice people. It looks like central casting out of an Al-Qaeda reunion or something. But, I'm sorry. I want to go to your phone calls in this segment, the next, and then we're going to get Bob Chapman on and cover the economy, but then I'm going to go through the smattering of the news we haven't gotten to yet and get Bob's take on it, because I always enjoy getting Bob's unique perspective on things. And let's go ahead and go to your phone calls. You know, I've done 2 hours and almost 2 hours of radio here, and I haven't plugged the fact that if you want to support the broadcast, please spread the word about the radio show, no matter how you listen. AM, FM, Global Shortwave, XM Satellite, the internet at InfoWars.com. Don't forget the free podcast, the free iPhone app. There's Droid apps out there that others have made as well that are free. Sometimes I get complaints about them, though, but they're not our apps. So, and our app's free, so you really can't complain too much about something that's free, even though our app has 4.5 stars. The point is, you're awake. You know what's going on. Help reach out to others. We're in a battle against corruption. We're seeing the fact that when we do take action, we have victories. But the establishment knows that and is going into high gear. We are in a race to the finish line against these tyrants. So please think about the radio show, spread the word about the broadcast, and also check out the online video bookstore at InfoWars.com this weekend. Right now, let's go to James in Arizona. Thanks for holding her on the air.
Hey, Alex. It's me, James. I'm the Marine who called in saying that the military's waking up a week ago or so. And,
yes.
So I've got some information for you. I've actually got a couple of things. One thing is from my many sources that it's very vague. The information I got is that they were exploring invading Libya. That somewhere along in the unit that one of my friends is in, they were exploring, and he wouldn't say who or what part of the unit was doing it, they were exploring invading Libya. Also, I have information about the military retirement plan, and apparently back on July 21st of this year, a month ago...
Yeah, they launched a new commission that's going to give regular enlisted a little bit of money to sell them on it, and then basically take, this is even in the Associated Press, half of the pension money of 20-year people and more. I'm sorry. Tell me what you learned.
Okay, so I actually have the slideshow. It was forwarded around. I have the emails, and I can forward you the emails, and I just kind of wanted to give you a heads up. I can send that stuff to you. I don't really know how it works, but I have the email, the chain of emails, and the actual slideshow from this presentation. I don't know if it's official. It looks official to me, and it went through the actual chain of command in one of the units. So it's the Defense Business Board, and it's modernizing the military retirement system, and it shows all these different think tanks and the RAND corporations on there, and my friends are really starting to wake up now because I've been talking about the RAND Corporation, and they see that now in that slideshow, so they're like, hey, you know, he knows what he's talking about.
Yeah, the RAND Corporation came up with all the major scams, almost all of them. Like they said, if we tell people to do a deductible, that will train them to start paying for insurance, even though they've paid for it, that you've got to pay later, and then we can phase in, and then, and they wrote the handbook on this 50 years ago, then we can phase in things we don't cover. Before, it was just they covered everything. You got insurance, they covered it. I mean, every scam you can imagine, every word game. And I actually saw RAND Corporation mentioned in this, but yes, I'm going to put you on hold, my friend, and give you an email to send those goodies to.
Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
Continuing with your phone calls, Bob Chapman coming up in the next segment in a plethora. That's a wide spectrum of news and information.
Would you say I am a plethora?
I got to watch the Three Amigos again. I was listening to Charlie Hodge locally earlier in the week and just playing clips on it. It's so funny. Let's go ahead and talk to Mike in Denver. Thanks for holding. You're on the air.
Hey, Alex. Thanks for having me. I know our time's growing short as a republic, and I think I've got three solutions, quick solutions, I'd just like your comments on. First one would be we physically take this place back like our forefathers did, which is the least desirable way. The second one is to hold the Federal Reserve Act up against Article 1, Section 8, Paragraph 5 of the Constitution in the Supreme Court and see if we can get it overturned. Third solution is to support Ron Paul all the way to office, and then support him every day by emailing and calling legislators and telling them to stay on board.
Well, those are all things that are avenues that could be gone down. I'm not saying I want offensive physical action. I'm saying obviously the cartridge box is always an option. But I think more important is just get the spirit of liberty out there. Create a culture of liberty. Rediscover that, hey, folks, watching football and acting cool, that's not what's valuable. All you men going around to barbecues, standing around going, look at my muscles, I'm tough. You know, you should be at the city council. You should be running for office. You should be standing up and going to your neighborhood meetings. You should be involved in the machinery of the world. But, I mean, a man doesn't just go, I got stuff to do. I'm not involved in that. Believe me, I'd like to be fishing every weekend. I'd like to be camping every weekend. I'd like to be hiking. I'd like to go to Monument Valley, Utah. I'd like to, you know, go to Colorado. I'd like to go. I can't do it. I can't do it. I can't do it because total tyranny's coming down on us. And folks are going to learn later. See, we're planting seeds right now, brother. Stuff's going to get so horrible in the future that there's millions and millions, tens of millions, who've heard this show, laughed at it, and it's already happening. Folks going, man, I thought you were crazy 10 years ago. It all came true. Wait till the rest of this stuff starts happening. And so plant the seeds. Get as, because right now, you know, people are starting to wake up, but it's going to get more crazy, okay?
You know, I agree, and I think you and your crew have done far more than you imagined to reawaken the spirit of liberty. in this country. And you guys, I know you don't like thanks, but you all deserve so much of that.
Well, listen, sure, you can say, man, thank you so much for putting out the fire that was going to burn down my house. Your house is next door to mine. Now, I like you, my neighbor. I would put it out anyways if my house was down the street. But, I mean, I'm in there trying to put the fire out because the flames are coming over to my house. And see, that's the thing. When I see cops follow orders that are unconstitutional, the cop's burning down his own house. He's burning down his own future. They've openly announced they're going to take all their pension funds when they're done. I mean, you people have no idea of those that serve this corruption. This thing's going all the way to the bottom. The globalists have a plan to absolutely bankrupt everybody but them. They're going to sit offshore and just carry out this havoc. They have a philosophy of neo-eugenics. And I could call it Nazism, but the Nazis got their system from these guys. These guys, though, walk around with NPR voices and limp wrist as a camouflage cover so you don't think they're threatening. These are savage, hardcore killers who like it. They are so dominant, so hyper-dominant, they have the ancient instinct to take control, poison, dumb down, and finally kill their opposition. This is total war with the banksters. Okay? I don't want people to understand that. This is... Don't let the simpering voices and the fool you. These are dragons, and they come to eat you and your family. All right. I mean, look at history. We'll be right back with Bob Chapman. More of your phone calls. Tons of key news straight ahead.
From his Central Texas Command Center, deep behind enemy lines, the information war continues. It's Alex Jones and the GCN Radio Network.
Well, Hurricane Irene is barreling towards the East Coast. All eyes are on the East, set to make landfall very, very soon. We'll give you a report on that coming up, but it's set to hit the East Coast dead square into North Carolina, Virginia, and then right up into New Jersey, New York, and all the way up into Maine before continuing up into Canada. And I guess winding up way up there by, is that Newfoundland up there? Is my geography right? you can follow it all at InfoWars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. And Drudge, of course, has it front and center. He's got the satellite, the cone, the stats. We'll follow it over the weekend. You know, I'd love to think that the government would help people if everything collapses, but what they'll do is lock everything down and show up at people's houses that are fine and say, you got a gun safe, we're going to blow it open unless you open it, give us your guns. But why? This is America. Get on the ground, get on the ground. They do that all over the country now. Any excuse to confiscate guns, they want to see if the military will do it. That's their big goal, their big apple in the sky that they're constantly reaching for. Now, we're going to Bob Chapman here in a moment. We'll continue with your phone calls, but here's some of the other crazy news. China expanding its nuclear stockpile. And, of course, they've got hundreds and hundreds of ICBMs, but now they're adding another 75 long-range nuclear missiles because you like to buy toasters from their slave camps. I guess so do I. I mean, I try to stay away from it. But death toll rises to 53, an attack on Mexican casino, the drug gang terrorist, I guess who hadn't been paid their protection money, poured gasoline on all the major entrances, set the hotel casino on fire, and killed at least 53 gamblers and employees. Mexico is a nightmare state, and it's because the public's disarmed. The government is a narco-terrorist state, openly controlling the drugs. And it got their society got so criminal that all these other drug gangs rose up and said, we got guns, too. So they have whole sectors they've controlled. Every day I read about whole police departments resigning, mayors being killed. And this is where this law of the gun ends up going. When only the government has the gun, then the government engages in a kleptocratic type of activity. Things just degenerate into a road warrior situation. And you notice that's happening with the globalist here. The police that are left that they aren't going to lay off are just going to be there to raise money off of you. So that's a crazy article. Japan's prime minister resigned. Successor race hard to call, and many of the top scientists have resigned and said, indeed, there were total meltdowns at the reactor that are still ongoing and massive radiation poisoning, and the government ordered it all covered up. As we said from the beginning, proven right again, we were called conspiracy theorists. And when the radiation levels went up in the U.S., the EPA just raised the level of what they said was safe. Oh, you caught us putting radioactive isotopes in your fluoride mix? We'll just raise the level on that, too. Local news listened to us, went out and stuck Geiger counters up against the pipes, and, whoa, that's high radiation. Where's it coming from? It must be in the aquifers. Now, move along, children. Nothing to see here. No, it's in the fluoride they're adding. I think that's a big piece of news. They spike 70-plus percent of the country's water with uranium, but again, I'm an extremist. A Russian spacecraft, of course, falls from the sky. Is the International Space Station in trouble? Very interesting report there. Moscow, an unnamed Russian space freighter, which was launched on a supply mission to the International Space Station, careened out of control and blew up in a thunderous fireball over Siberia Wednesday. Greece has been forced to tap emergency fund. You notice the deeper they get into the banker bailout, the worse things get. Greece has been forced to activate an obscure emergency fund for its banks because they are running short on collateral that is acceptable to the European Central Bank. And joining us to talk about this and Ben Bernanke's latest announcement as well on QE3, supposedly isn't going to happen, but Dr. Roberts said they're still doing it via the monetization of the T-bills, is Bob Chapman. We'll also talk about Libya and a lot more. But Bob, you know, you've been fighting the globalists for 50 years, and their documents were public then, and then the Dodd Commission came out, Norman Dodd and others, where they planned to set up a world government, get everybody in debt, implode the nation states, and have a new bank of the world. And now we see it being announced, and Europe's told there's a new financial dictatorship run by private banks, and they will dictate everything, not your parliaments, not your governments, and we have a super Congress now that originates the spending and tax bills, not the regular Congress for the first time in 200 plus years. We are seeing just incredible things, Bob, and it's almost like we make it passe in a way. We actually help the establishment if we just sit here and talk about this and then don't remind people of how incredible it is. I mean, I'm almost conditioned. It's like if this stuff was happening 10 years ago, people would be freaking out. But they incrementally got us so trained to accept it that now we're seeing articles every day. Get rid of the Constitution. Yeah, the government brings in narcotics. What you going to do about it? I mean, there's just this arrogance. And the former head of the Fed, Greenspan, saying we're above the law on Lehr NewsHour. No one can investigate us. No one can look into us. And we'll just print money. And I mean, it's, what's that Italian mafia thing where you flick your hand under your chin, you know, basically saying go to Hades, Bob? What are we facing here?
Going to Hades, just as you pointed out. They have had to expedite their program. That's why what you're seeing is becoming something that the major media is starting to handle. And yes, they want to break everybody. There's no question about that financially. And they want to reduce population, depending upon who within the CFR and the Trilateral Commission you want to listen to, anywhere between 60 and 90%. So that means there's not going to be many of us left. As far as the situation in Europe is concerned, what the European Central Bank just did violates their rules in purchasing the bonds of Spain and Italy, among others, and it also violates the German Constitution. And I think we're coming up to the first week in September, and all of these people who have taken their vacations, well, you might say Europe burned, which is incredible, like it was going to go away. It's probably the worst financial crisis in peacetime that Europe has seen in 100 or more years, and they're on vacation. But anyway, they're going to come back and face reality very shortly, and I don't think anything's going to get done because the Germans have said, look, to the ECV, what you're doing is illegal and wrong. And they spent about $100 billion buying these bonds. And they expect that these individual countries within the European Union, particularly the Eurozone, the European Union's 27 countries, Eurozone 17 of those 27. And they expect them to come to the rescue and come up with the money to buy this or pay for these bonds that have been purchased. And the ECB has no authority to do what they've done. So the Germans are saying, look, we're not going to do that. I don't know who's going to pay you for them, but it's not going to be us. And so they're at a standstill. There is no solution now because the Germans have said no. The Finnish haven't said no, but they want collateralization on the loans, and they want the Greeks to put up their gold.
So Bob, here's the issue. Everybody has seen example after example in third world countries and in the West bailing out the banks, which means staying in their Ponzi scheme because they hold you hostage, never fixes anything and only makes it worse. But if you're a bankster, you actually do win. So this is all by design, as we've broken it down for years. Now it's all happening just like we said it would, and it's accelerating. And we saw gold shoot up to 1900 and something, and they pushed it down, then it shot back up today. What's going on in the gold and silver markets right now?
Well, first of all, you can look back at May, and you saw the attack on silver, took it from $50 down to $32.50. And then it rallied back up to $44, and then they attacked it again. What they forgot was it works both ways. On the way down, with the high margins in a very thin market, they raised them from $4,500 to $21,600. And then the commodity houses that did gold and silver, they raised them to $42,000. They since rescinded that, as far as I know. But what they didn't figure was that when they brought it down, they wiped out all of the small and medium-sized investors, so that when silver started to go back up again, there was no resistance. There was nobody to sell. And so it was getting stronger and stronger, and that's why they attacked it again. But it's not lasting, as we can see today. I do a lot of programs, as you well know. And on Wednesday and on Thursday and again today, I'm telling people that we've hit the bottom in both gold and silver. They're going to head right back up again. What was done in gold, they increased the margin requirements from $4,500 to $8,000 or $9,000. I don't know the exact figure at the moment. It's in tomorrow's issue, incidentally. And what they are finding is they set this group of insiders, the big firms on Wall Street, the banks, brokerage firms, hedge funds, what they did was gave them the information or was given the information prior, and they all acted together, and they knocked gold down $200. And I came out on Wednesday and said, tomorrow's the bottom between 7 and 7.25. Go in and buy with both hands. I was a buyer.
Stay there. Let's talk about it on the other side, because it's shooting back up right now.
No one knows what it's like to be the bad man, to be the sad man behind blue eyes. No one knows what it's like to be hated, to be faded, to telling only lies.
Yeah, it must be rough to be the mainstream dying dinosaur media. No, the globalist dreams aren't as empty. They do have things they want to do. And we've seen their new world order. The control freaks like to wreck everything and consolidate it. That's what a cancer does. Now, here's some breaking news from Reuters. Russian central bank to offer gold-backed loans. Russia's central bank will offer gold-backed loans for up to 90 days at an interest rate of 7%. Wow. So we're starting to see that gold is becoming the real currency. That is a pretty high interest rate for 90 days. It said in a statement on Friday, expanding its lending facilities for dealing with any future liquidity crunch in the banking system. Bob, I want you to finish up with what they did in the market, driving it down artificially. And now it's up, I don't know, 40-something bucks today. So this is the standard deal where they create the perception that gold drops. And people are like, man, you're an idiot. Gold went down 200 bucks. And I'm like, yeah, but it's up 500 in the last few months. Look at the overall graph. And they're like, still, you're dumb. You bought it at 300. It's 18 plus. I'm like, well, no, I'm not. And they're like, yeah, you're a failure. Watch me jump off a cliff now. Government loves me. They really killed Bin Laden. The Easter Bunny's real. Finish up, Bob, and then we'll get into this Russia situation and some other news and phone calls.
Well, on Wednesday's issue, we told people tomorrow morning we'll hit 17 to 17:25. It'll be the turn. The professionals are licking their chops. You get in there with them and you buy both gold and silver.
How did you call the plunge? Because I know it's on record. In fact, we should toot your horn a little bit better. You did call it before it happened. How did you do that?
Well, the market is the market, and it gets overextended. We saw a lot of short covering going on, and I felt that it was normal to have a correction, usually $50 to $100, when you have an event like that. Well, it didn't do that. The government got a hold of it with their minions, and they attacked, drove it down 200. Well, they've got the same problem now they had with silver. They wiped out all of the small and medium-sized investors on the way down, and there's no resistance. And, of course, China and Russia and Venezuela and Brazil and Argentina and Iran and India and everybody who's a buyer of gold is, you know, they were wringing their hands and saying, you know, does the United States government understand they're just giving us gewgaws and gewgaws of money? And so, as you said, gold is up $47 right now, and silver's up 44 cents. And it's going to continue. It's going to go right back up again because it's a phony baloney deal. The underlying fundamentals are there. What are they? Gold's the only real money.
You know, Bob, it seemed like the banksters a few years ago thought they could really still buy their own bonds, monetize debt, but not cause inflation on the street. Now they seem to be abandoning it and hiding it in plain view and going, well, yeah, we're just going to print money. Oh, a little inflation's not bad. I mean, are they in control? I mean, I know they set this in motion. They think they're in control, but are things going well for them?
Well, let me give you an example. One of the things that you didn't point out in news for today, the Rothschilds have had to make a very large investment in Société Générale, which is one of the major banks in Paris, in France. And they had to do that because Society in general is broke. And so to answer your question, if Rothschild has to go in and bail out a bank, you know they're in serious trouble. Well, same thing's been going on in the United States, and all the banks in Europe and the United States are carrying two sets of books.
Now, let me ask you a question. If Buffett puts in $5 billion, the Rothschilds put in however many billions they put in, I didn't see that. And then you're talking about hundreds of trillions conservatively. That's the real hangover. How can $5 billion prop up, you know, $100 trillion, as Max Kaiser was saying in Bank of America? Are they leveraging into derivatives again with fractional reserve to the power of 1,000 with that $5 billion? I mean, how does Buffett, quote, save Bank of America with $5 billion?
Well, first of all, it's a drop in the bucket, and the leverage that you're talking about, yes, it's there, and they are using it. It's a last gasp resort. It's the same as SoGen is in Paris, and it's not going to work. How long will it last? I don't know. 3, 6, 9 months, and it's over. And, you know, Buffett has made his money on inside information, knowing what the government's going to do, and the Illuminati. Every time they need a favor, because he and Soros and people like them.
Stay there, stay there.
Came in last night at 10:30. That baby of mine wouldn't let me in. So move it on over.
Move it on over.
Move it on over.
Move it on over.
Move over, little dog, cause the big dog's moving in. Change the
knock on our front door. My door key don't fit no more, so get it on over.
Move it on over.
Scoot it on over.
Move it on over.
Move over, skinny dog, cause the fat dog's moving in.
We are back live. Alex Jones here.
The house here is mighty small.
Hank Williams, the legend.
No house at all, so ease it on over.
The hillbilly in me really likes that, don't you? Admit you love it. Monday through Friday from 11 a.m. until 2 p.m., we are here live. And don't forget, my friends, we come back Sundays, and I'll be live this Sunday, 4 to 6 p.m. It seems like every 5 minutes it's back to Sunday or it's back to Monday. I mean, life just speeds up. I remember growing up when it took what felt like 100 years to get to Christmas. And the Christmas tree lights and the presents. What I really liked was the family dinners and the food and the cold weather and the family time. And it would just take forever to get to Christmas. Now Christmas is like bam, 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 bam. Life is just speeding past us. And think of all of our ancestors, all of your ancestors going way back in time. They had hopes. They had dreams. They sacrificed so that their children could have a better life. Many people died, so we'd have the basic liberties we have today. And I see these grown men and women who think it's a trendy affectation to laugh at people that are worried about tyranny, to laugh at people that are worried about corruption, to giggle and smirk at someone that talks about their rights. It's kooky. It's weird. Oh, these weirdos are talking about the Federal Reserve being private. I remember being called a conspiracy theorist 16 years ago. And people calling the radio station and going, is this guy racist? I heard that's code for racism. And you saw that last year. You don't like government-run healthcare? You're a racist. I mean, just desperate tactics. But the good news is it doesn't work anymore. A large portion of the population, nearing a majority, well, Congress has the lowest approval rating ever. What, only 9% of Americans think that the Congress serves them? People are awake. They're just not. You ever woke up in a hotel room and you don't know where you are for a minute? You're like, this doesn't look like my bedroom in the dark. You go, oh, yeah, I'm in a hotel room. You wake up, and there's like an ambulance going by, and you're in New York City, and you're like, And you're like, oh, yeah, I'm in New York. People need to just wake up out of the trance. We're not in Kansas anymore. And everything that the global bankers have done in other countries, everything they write about, they're very arrogant. You know, Bob Chapman, I think that's one of their biggest weak spots in the social engineering system is that they do love to brag. They do in their own publications that they don't think the general public reads. They do admit a lot of what they were planning, and that's how you and others were able to lay out their program long before it happened.
Well, that's why I have been a subscriber to Foreign Affairs, the house organ of the Council of Foreign Relations since 1960. You know, we were talking about Europe a few minutes ago, and one of the things that they're trying to keep from the people of the world, the Germans are well aware of it, but the Federal Constitutional Court in Karlsruhe is going to, on September the 15th, vote upon or say whether the German government spending of citizens' money to bail out foreign relations, foreign nations, is legal, and they're not talking about it. And I think they're going to say, no, you can't do that. And then where is the ECB going to be? And they're not going to be able to lend anybody any money. And that's going to bring the whole thing down. And down it should. This was originally created. There was the European gold, coal and steel community, followed by the European common market. And now we've got the European Union, and what they wanted to make out of this was this would be the model for one world government, the euro would be the model for the one world currency, and they screwed it up.
And they openly have written countless books saying that. We covered my seminal film, Endgame. I mean, they admit this is the model, and you're saying, Bob, they've screwed it up. I mean, I see that countries are balking, Germany, chief amongst them, and then France and others, because the public doesn't want to, quote, bail out banks. They sell it as a loan to Portugal or Italy or Ireland or Greece. When you read the fine print, it's just money directly to the central banks. But isn't that their end game, to implode these countries? And so perhaps all along they plan to implode the euro and move directly to just a bank of the world. I mean, they were just talking about that 3 years ago, and perhaps the world will bow. Because they'll tell trendies it's cool, and a lot of trendies will probably put stickers on their cars to the new global government bank and actually teach their children that it's good to be a slave. I mean, I'm not kidding. If you tell the average trendy, especially some, you know, business graduate, that throwing their kids in a meat grinder is cool, they'll do it. And so people will probably just be like bowing down to the Rothschilds and pulling their teeth out. If they have gold in their teeth with pliers, and saying, "Here, Lord Rothschild, take it." And Rothschild's like, "No, but I will tax you for breathing." That's how far this has gone, Bob.
You're right. And the situation in Europe has gone to the point where it's now irretrievable. And can you believe that they took all of August off and didn't even deal with it? It shows you how the bureaucrats in Europe, through socialism, have just become dead ends. And so, you know, you asked whether this was planned. I don't think so. I think they really made a mess out of this. They know what they'd like to do now, but it's going to be too hard to pull off. I mean, when you see Rothschild going into Sogen and putting up the money, and you see the Buffetts of the world popping in with $5 billion here and there just to extend things for another 3 or 6 months, you know they're in serious trouble. It's going down. How long will it take? I don't know. What other tricks can they pull? I don't know. They're very good at it, incidentally, and they're not stupid. But they've made some fierce mistakes, and they're going to pay for it. But this is not going to go away. Things are going to continue to deteriorate, and that's why we have to protect ourselves by having dehydrated and freeze-dried foods in a filter and weapons to defend our family and gold and silver to put our valuable wealth that we've already accumulated into.
Well, you're certainly right, Bob. I want to take some phone calls, but first I wanted to raise a couple other issues with you. I was going to premiere it here on the show today, but we just ran out of time. So I want to ask all the radio listeners and TV viewers to please go get this video that's now posted at Infowars.com. And a lot of times I read a headline, even though I wrote it, and it's not strong enough. 911 heroes not welcome at Ground Zero. And that's actually kind of a whitewash. It's 911 heroes barred or banned at Ground Zero. Fox, CNN, they all admit it. And they just say, we just don't want you here. We're not going to say why. Well, I know why. I know why they don't want them there. But this just shows how crazy it is and how they set up the whole police state in the name of protecting us because of what happened on 9/11. And then the government wraps themselves in the heroics of the police officers and firefighters and medical people and doctors and folks. And then they're barred from being there, but tens of thousands of others aren't. They're still going to have, you know, the police chief and fire chief up there, and they said they'll have a token event for them. But why would they be barred from the big police state extravaganza? Because either way you cut it, Bob, they are heroes. Sure, it's an inside job, but they didn't know that. Always the establishment tries to say, oh, you're saying the firemen were involved blowing it up? No. No. Again, that's a game they play. But now here are the pro-official story people barring first responders. Why do you think that is, Bob?
I think they want it to go away. They don't want these good people to be seen as good people. They just want to make it a non-event from here on out, because too many people, professionals, have discovered that the whole thing was a scam. And they don't want to talk about. They want it all to die and go away. And, 9/11's coming up. And they want to be as quiet about it as possible. And so there can't be any heroes.
Well, that's right. The only heroes can be Obama and George W. Bush up there. But The info I have, Bob, and I cover this in the video, is I would go there 6 years ago, and about half the firemen and police were mad at us. The others were shaking our hands and telling us, you know, that they appreciated us. When I was there a couple years ago, and I really ought to go this year, just so I can document this even more, now it was firemen running over, police running over. Like three different restaurants, firemen that were there would buy our dinner, even though they were, you know, across the room from us. And I would see, like, firemen in their commander outfits, because they were all, you know, veterans of 9/11. They were there in their dress uniforms. Would say, Alex, we appreciate you. We know the truth. Thank you. And cops were doing it. Now, again, these were people all in their dress uniforms because they'd been there. That's why they won't let them in the pit. That's why they won't let them in with the new memorial and all that, because they know they're a bunch of 9/11 truthers, Bob. I've got to say it's like 80% of them. And I've had some of the heads of the biggest victim 9/11 families on, and they've said years ago that the majority were 9/11 truthers.
And I believe that. But I think it's high. I think your 80% figure is there. Because we've had this 10 years to look the whole thing over and watch the government lie. And, you know, people in law enforcement aren't stupid. I mean, they're beset with all kinds of problems every day that we'll never run into. And so they think outside the box very often.
Absolutely. Now, I use that word absolutely a lot because it's absolutely true. You just start saying, affirmative, Bob. You're absolutely right.
Affirmative, huh?
I just did it again.
We used to use that in the military, but that's been over 50 years for me.
We need to pull up a thesaurus for you're correct or 100% or on target. Nail on the head, Bob. There we go.
I read you.
I read you. Over. Okay, I want to go to these calls. We got some really bad news. We had the earthquake obviously hit. And they said that was a once-in-a-century event. Very weird. And now Irene's coming in, and in an unprecedented decision, nearly 300,000 people who live in the flood-prone areas of New York City were ordered to evacuate today. This just happened as Hurricane Irene set its sights on the nation's largest city. New Yorkers, can you imagine the hellhole that's going to be with people trying to get out of there? New Yorkers, many of them without cars, don't have much time to get out of the way before the city shutters its subways, buses, and trains on Saturday. And I had my numbers here of when Irene is supposed to hit. Let me look this up here. This is kind of like Katrina, where it snuck up on people. You know, I took my first cruise during Hurricane Katrina, because I didn't know. I knew the tickets were cheaper in hurricane season, like an idiot. We leave on the Carnival Cruise Line to the Western Caribbean, Cozumel and all those places, Bob. And then on our way back, they're not telling everybody to be scared on the two-day cruise back. All of the bar people, though, are around the TVs looking completely scared. So I started talking to them. And the waves were only about 10 feet then. The ship was moving a bit. 30-plus foot swells once we got up close to Galveston, because it came in on Sunday afternoon. They were thinking about parking in Mexico, but they made the decision because Katrina kind of sat there off Florida, strangely, spinning for a day. So they started racing. And, of course, the Azipod stabilizers weren't working. They closed most of the decks. Water was coming in. Alarms were going off. I mean, but in a way, I've been on like five cruises now. It's my favorite trip now that we survived it, because I remember those waves and the sun setting and rising with like 35-foot waves and how crazy it was. You ever been in high seas like that, Bob? I bet you have.
I certainly have, and I got to tell you this very briefly. When I went over and back to Europe, I was on a Liberty ship. And when you have a North Atlantic storm, say in the wintertime, 35 feet is nothing. And I've seen everything on the tables for breakfast leave the tables. And we spend the next 3 hours cleaning the floors. But yes, I've been in them, and they are terrifying. I've seen water come right through the portholes.
Well, see, the Liberty ship was a lot smaller, and of course, those were welded together, and all the time in big storms, for those that don't know, would break in two. I was in a giant cruise ship, and still, I mean, it was going, and tables were falling over, and water was coming in, and let me tell you, folks were scared, but it's weird how, though, after the fact, it was, do you kind of have a fond memory of your Liberty ship experience?
I do, because it taught me how powerful the sea was, and I was fortunate that it didn't get any worse than it did.
Well, that hurricane literally chased us. And remember, it hit Sunday night, Monday morning. And so we got into port, and for 3 days I was stumbling around. And then the next day, that sucker just came right in. I mean, here's our ship, and here's that hurricane just chasing us. And it was amazing. So we got to pray for folks in New York. Mayor Michael Bloomberg ordered an evacuation by 5 p.m. Saturday for low-lying areas of about 270,000 people. Meanwhile, subway, buses, and commuter trains in the city of Long Island and in the northern suburbs will begin their final runs around noon Saturday. What about all the old people and folks that aren't going to be able to get out, and then they're going to shut everything down, Bob?
I don't know what they're going to do. I would think that public service would take care of that, the fire department in particular, and any other organization they have, and get them someplace else.
Well, I sure hope. Of course, if any cops or firemen actually save anybody, they'll probably be barred from any type of memorial services. How do you bar the heroes of 9/11 from the memorial service? What a blatant... It's so bizarre. I can't even believe that, Bob.
Pure arrogance. And it's just as you explained before, the arrogance is going to be their downfall. And I contend you're absolutely perfectly correct. And it's something that's been with these kind of people for centuries. They think they can do anything, and they're the masters of the universe, if you may. And it doesn't work out that way. There's millions of people in the world, all over the world, who are far smarter than they are, who just want to see people live and have a life and die. And that's not good enough for these bad people. They want everybody to die so they can have 20 or 30% of the population to run around as slaves. It's like ancient Egypt or whatever.
And if you look at the globalist plan, it's crazy. I mean, by the time they actually start getting into the final phases of it, it turns the planet into some type of Dante's Inferno.
He's going the distance. He's going for speed. She's all alone in a time of need. Because he's racing and pacing. And
you know, Bob, it looks outrageous to bar the police, firefighters, and medical workers and military from Ground Zero, the actual heroes. They're admittedly going to have some representatives there to grandstand and so they can say they're heroes, people that weren't involved. It shows the fact that the government knows the police and people are really waking up to them. I think this is a key report. I want to do a little bit of overdrive. It'll be PrisonPlanet.tv and InfoWars audio stream only into the next hour so I can get to people that have been holding a while, like Sean in Australia, James, Jack, Keith, Nick, and I want to see a Bob hold over with us as well. If you want to get a free complimentary copy of the International Forecaster, you can call 800-686-2237. You can also call and get two silver dollars with free shipping for $88. That's already an insanely good deal. And they get a free book and free documentary film. Excellent film about the banksters. Free. So three free gifts. Free shipping, free film, free book with a great price on the silver dollars. 800-686-2237. 800-686-2237. Also want to tell you about Survival RX. Legislation like Codex Alimentarius threatens our ability to purchase vitamins and supplements in the future. Our new sponsor, Survival RX, I think this is a great idea, has been the world's first long-term storable vitamin and nutritional supplements. They're a big supplement company, but now they've come out with this. They created a proprietary triple nitrogen flush manufacturing process that will allow you to store the high-quality vitamins for decades. For now, through the end of August, they are offering free shipping inside the continental U.S. for listeners of this show. Survival RX, just the word survivalrx.com. Check them out today. And finally, speaking of food, eFoodsDirect.com is celebrating their 30th anniversary with a great deal. Save 30% off the Food Freedom Unit 1-year food supply. Here's your chance to save 500 and $36.70 off their already low price for a one-year supply of the best horrible foods on the planet. This price is even lower than when they first went into business in 1981. They're the biggest company out there because they have the highest quality, and I've shopped all over. They're the place to go. eFoodsDirect.com/Alex, eFoodsDirect.com/Alex, or 800-409-5633, 800-409-5633. Let's go to Keith in Texas with Bob Chapman. Keith, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hey, Alex, great show today. The Rush Limbaugh show has been info-bombed. We plugged We Are Change twice on his show to his 20 million plus listeners. You can find it on Funkmaster 5. The video is up right now.
Well, that's awesome. I wish you'd have got a succulentinfowar.com in, because I think a lot of the Rush listeners will think We Are Change is an Obama thing because it has the word. But I mean, I'm glad you did that. It's just that an Infowars.com would have been better.
Hey, we got a lot of calls in the future. There's plenty of time, plenty of
So what happened when you got, I mean, did you get the URL in, though?
Yeah, and I also mentioned to Google search it, because if you Google search it, it takes you right to not just the main page, but all the chapters.
No, that's good. No, that is good. I'm glad that happened then. I just thought you were saying the name We Are Change. I'm kind of like, well, people won't find that. But no, that's super awesome. Getting back to, what did Lord Limbaugh do when you did that?
You know, he was... He's always been, you know, the least abrasive of the disinfo agents out there when I do make these calls. He was, you know, fairly decent. He jumped on Muslim terrorism, you know, kind of as a diversion, but, you know, it was too late. I already got the plugs in. And, you know, he wasn't too bad, but, you know, after a while, he did cut me off like they usually do.
Well, I love the fact that We Are Change came out of Luke Radowski being persecuted by the cops and us covering it on this show and people picking up the banner of liberty and it's spreading all over the country and all over the world. Another example of the fact that no army can stop an idea whose time has come. Bob Chapman is our guest. A little bit of overdrive coming up as we continue with your phone calls. Don't forget, we've got a new special report with Lou Rockwell and more at PrisonPlanet.tv. By the way, in the lead up to 9/11, they've got all these TV shows and programs trying to prop up the official story. And they're trying to run this hoax, Bob Chapman joining us, of saying, well, 9/11 truth's been discredited. Kind of like, yeah, Mark Twain's dead years before he was actually dead. And he said, rumors of my death have been greatly exaggerated. Their little psychological tactics of like Ron Paul can't win, more and more it's backfiring, Bob.
It certainly is. And I think, again and again, it's talk radio, the alternative media, and in the internet. And again, Brzezinski has it all laid out for the last 3 years, telling his fellow One Worlders, look, these guys are breathing down your collar. You better do something about it, or the consequences are going to be dreadful. And we've heightened it, and we're pushing him. And I know that in the shows I'm on, I'm always in the top three and very often number one. And so the people are listening. They want to hear what's going on out there. And so we are making great headway.
We certainly are. Let's take another call. Sean in Australia, thanks for holding her on the air with Bob Chapman.
Yeah, hi, Bob and Alex. How are you guys tonight?
Good, thank you.
Yeah, good. Well, I'm ringing up to actually provide, I guess, the Ron Paul campaign and unwary Texans and unwary people in the world some information about the biotech engineer who developed the Gardasil vaccine. Now, that was back in 2006, a guy by the name of Ian Fraser, who's who works at the Queensland University in Australia. He's also the president of the Cancer Council in Australia. He advises the World Health Organization and the Belinda and Bill Gates Foundation. He's recently...
And I was aware of that. There's something special about that live virus vaccine. Very special that Bill and Melinda Gates want you to take it. And so important that Rick Perry would try to basically murder every girl in Texas. You even heard Lou Rockwell call him a brutal murdering criminal earlier.
Well, yeah, I mean, you've got to look at the people behind these just faces in the public, you know. They're nothing more than a face. But he's actually developing a skin cancer vaccine. Now, this is obviously very easy to push on the Australians because, you know, we love the sun. And it was seen in the Sunday Times, we get in Perth, Western Australia. I was on the front page of the Sunday Times about 4 weeks ago, and it was saying, it was basically being hailed as a breakthrough before it actually is.
Well, what's so incredible, my friend, about this fraud is that on the drug zone insert, it says it isn't even proven to stop cervical cancer. And it only covers a few of the viruses. There's thousands of variants. It's a total hoax. And I was aware, and I saw that like a week. I needed to cover that. Now they're going to try to push a skin cancer vaccine. And see, what they do is they put cancer viruses in you through vaccines. Then they come out as cancer becomes like the common cold with vaccines that'll cure you, but then do something else to you. Bob Chapman, what do you think about this?
Well, I think it's terrible, and it's been going on for years and years. I mean, during the war, the Second Great War, we saw German scientists doing all sorts of horrible things, and they didn't seem to have any trouble doing it. And now we have a universal attitude by scientists that, well, it's okay to do that stuff. And, of course, it's not okay. I mean, who in their right mind would do a horrible thing like that? Rick Perry, perhaps, and the scientists who gave the instrument to, in this case, Gardasil, to do such a thing. In fact, I mentioned that in tomorrow's International Forecaster and some of the things we spoke about last Friday.
Hey, absolutely. Listen, Sean, you want to write an article from an Australian perspective and send it to showtips at Infowars.com or send it to writers at Infowars.com, as we carry a lot of stuff that listeners write. If it's sourced and documented, please help us out with that, Sean. Thank you so much. And tie the whole Rick Perry thing into it. I'm sorry to everybody else. Oh, I wanted to talk to Jack in Florida. I listened on 8:10 a.m. Oh, you know what? We'll come back with Bob if he'll do it. We'll do one more segment. But everybody just hung. Hey, we got a KOMY 1340 a.m. listener, too. Central, that's 12 noon to 3 p.m. Eastern. Back Sundays, 4 to 6 p.m. Central. We're here live. And starting next Thursday, 7 o'clock every night, at least a 30-minute, hard-hitting, focused, condensed news transmission of all the important news of the day with other special reports on big issues like cancer viruses in the vaccines, bisphenol A, put in the products to sterilize men, give women cancer. I've got so much stuff coming out that is going to be groundbreaking research. But again, condensed so you can just download it off prisonplanet.tv, burn it to the disk, share it with friends, whatever. And we couldn't have done any of this without the InfoWarriors out there that have supported the shows over the years. It is so exciting. And I'm not somebody full of courage. I'm not somebody who needs to even be thanked. It is a pleasure to spend my time and energy and to pour out my will, my essence, my energy on a worthy cause. I am incredibly honored to be so prominent in the fight for human liberty. In fact, I don't feel worthy, if you really want to know. That's why when people say how great I am or how good I am, it's actually almost like hot coals being dumped on me, because I appreciate them saying that. But I think, man, I got to do a better job. Man, I've got to work harder. I got to sleep more. I've got to work out more, you know, to be healthier. I've got to do more research. I've got to get more focused. But then I do more work, and then I get exhausted. And then I'm not as honed. I mean, it's a total commitment. We're going to go back to Bob and your calls right now, but I wanted to get Bob's take on what I'm saying and see if he's experienced this in life as well. I would imagine he has. It's just that you realize how short life is, and you just want your children to have a good future. And as angry as I get at myself for not doing enough, do you know what it's like to look at people who have no idea what's coming down and to see them totally focused on things that don't even matter? And that they laugh at those of us that are informed. But it's strange. I've also experienced things in life that very few people get to experience. A lot of people want to do something they've never done. It gets hyped up. They think it's going to be magical. It's going to be incredible. And then you get it, and it's not. And for me, the simple things become more and more important every day. Just sitting and reading a book. Watercoloring with my children, going fishing, just sitting on the back porch, stillness, quiet. And then I think about the general public, totally sold out to Madison Avenue, feeling inadequate because the television told them so. They've never met big top rock stars or the biggest Hollywood stars there are. They've never been invited to the most elite parties. I mean, I turn these things down 9 times out of 10. Because I'd rather just be home. I'd rather be here researching. I'd rather be here fighting. And I'm not saying, oh, look at me, I'm a big man. I've broken through to the other side. I'm telling people, don't feel inadequate because you're living in a little apartment. Don't feel inadequate because your hair's falling out. Don't feel inadequate because you don't have the latest trendy clothes. Don't feel inadequate because you can't take that Hawaii vacation. The world is all around you. Mystery, beauty, the secrets of the universe. And I've been wanting to talk about this all week and just got busy with the news and didn't get into it. I have had a taste of things that most people never had. I've had people land and pick me up in private wide-body jets. I've known the biggest rock stars on the planet. I've known some of the biggest film directors on the planet, some of the biggest movie stars on the planet, most of which you never even hear me say their names. And sure, it's interesting. It's kind of cool to be sitting across the table from somebody you've seen in the movies. And, get to know them and find out they're real people. But then you find out they're just like you. And they're interested in what you're doing because you're their hero. It's really weird. And then you realize there's nothing more. The system always sells you in that there's got to be something more. The system always sells you on that you are worthless. The truth is you're powerful. You're interesting. And I see so many people who just marvel at someone that is famous. And I know, Bob, you've known a lot of famous people, been one of the biggest silver and gold brokers, wealthy man, Malibu, all that stuff. Do you agree with what I just said?
I couldn't have said it better. And some of the things, even though I've been involved in this for over 50 years, some of the things that you've discovered already, it took me probably 10 or 15 years longer to discover them than you have. But that's not surprising because the alacrity of news and things that are going on.
Things
today
are sped up now. It's already been trailblazed.
You're right, and so I think the bottom line is don't expect too much out of life. Just get the most out of it you can for yourself and your family and your friends, and try to do things that are going to help other people who don't understand what you do. And that's what Alex and I do. I mean, who knows anybody else who spends as long on radio every week at 76 years old than I do. I mean, I love it.
Well, exactly. I mean, that's the issue is that, but it's not even an obsession. It is a total giving over to something. I only enjoy now fighting corruption, exposing liars, and spending time with my family. To the point of now, it's not even good for the show that I don't want to call up famous people and get them on, even though it would help the show. I just don't even care. It's like more and more, this whole world and what we're told is important isn't important to me anymore. And it's almost empowering, but it's also kind of crippling in a way because you start to leave the world. But I'm actually joining the real world. I'm getting away from this fake projection. Do you see what I'm saying?
Absolutely. And then, you know, what you'll find, which I did when I was in my 50s, is that the accumulation of things stops, and you become a disaccumulator, and your whole life changes. And I think most people go through that. And as you get older, if you continue in your field, you get better and better. And I think the apex of the average person's life is from 50 onward, because you've had a chance to learn the things that you need to know, whether it's in your profession or the way of life. And yes, a lot of people get passed by, but they don't open the door. You've got to be on a quest to find out new things. I love being with young people. I've lived a long time with older people, and I prefer to be with young people because it keeps you young.
You couldn't be more right. And again, I went into this just short little piece, and we're going to Nick and Jack and James and a few others here in just a moment, Jeff and Freddie. It's just that I see people so captured by television, so captured by sitcoms, so captured by this fake culture, and they've never attained, most of them, real success, and so that's why they're feeling lacking. And I'm just trying to explain to them, success is going down to the Salvation Army and feeding homeless people on Christmas Eve. Success is painting an oil painting. Success is gardening and growing good carrots. Success is enjoying the beauty of the stars at night. Success is just loving life and being appreciative. And I just see so many people who are so empty. And Bob, I'm the opposite. I can tell you're, you know, like me. I am almost exploding and burning with fulfillment and satisfaction. And then it's torture to see how other people are not. And it's a mind game. And I was already fulfilled to a great extent, but I was really fulfilled once I had a lot of success and met a lot of high-powered people and found out that it was nothing special, that I wasn't missing anything, that I had the Holy Grail all along. Do you see what I'm saying?
And you didn't know it, but now you discovered it, and you're right. And, of course, living among famous people, which I did in many places, never mind Malibu, you very quickly find out that they're not much different than you are. It's just that they've reached the apex in their field, and a rock star or whatever, or a great attorney, or so on and so forth. And so you have to take what you can get from life, and then what you learn, transfer to younger people so that they can know what to expect.
Yeah, I think that's the essential. Sorry, go ahead.
Right now.
No, what were you saying, Bob? Because I missed it.
I said gold just crossed over. It's up over $50.
Wow. Yeah, as you predicted. Let's go to Nick, who's been holding on KOMY 1340 AM. And then we're going to go to Jack in Florida, listing on 810 AM WEUS in Orlando, the Big Ten. Go ahead and make your point, Nick, and thank you for holding.
Afternoon. I've been waiting long enough to see the sun clear. I'm about 6 miles off the Pacific. Close to Salinas, where they have the rodeo, and you'd be happy to know a Texan took the bull riding last July.
Wait, so you're out in the ocean listing right now?
6 miles off.
Wow, well, thank you for holding, sir. I go ahead.
Okay, I got some weather modification thoughts to give you, but first of all, I heard the thought of a power of controlling lies, counterfeiting lies. And I have to, you got Bob there. A lot of the gold is being bought up by Wall Street, so that makes that'll raise the price. I had some thoughts I wanted to give you about weather modification. It went like Texas wildfires ignite Category 5 over Alabama. You know, that can be proved. That was a time when you were saying the Russians can kill with weather modification.
Well, I was reading out on even the Wall Street Journal and New York Times admitting that earthquakes can be man-made. They can be triggered. And that's been known for decades, but the general public just isn't aware of it.
Gulf oil spill suppresses a hurricane. You know, there was a hurricane back then, and it fizzled out before it got anywhere. And that technology was known back in the 60s. Just coat the ocean with oil.
Well, yeah, all I want to say is I wish I was with you out there off the coast of Santa Cruz, because I've been there, and it is ultra beautiful, and I am envious of you to no length. I mean, it's just, they talk about that as the beauty of Santa Cruz and that blue water. God bless you. I appreciate your call. Very interesting points there. Let's talk to Jack, listening on 810 AM in Orlando. Go ahead. You're on the air. Thanks for holding.
Yeah, hello, Alex. Thanks for what you do.
Thank you. What's on your mind?
I got two issues. One, I believe it would help the Ron Paul's campaign. Last time we had the election for president, when Ron Paul ran then, you had Lou Dobbs. He was on his program promoting everybody go register independent. And that blowed Ron Paul out of the election in the primary. Hopefully you can get back in touch with him and talk to him and maybe get him not to do that again, because that really hurt Ron Paul. He's running Republican, so in the primary in a lot of states, you have to be registered as a Republican just to be able to vote for him.
You know, it seems I remember that, and we can get Lou on. In fact, I was just telling Jaron I want to get Lou Dobbs back on, but I don't want to really criticize him on air, but I can ask him about that. The main reason I want to get him on is get his view on the economy and Obama trying to legalize the illegals by fiat. I mean, folks, the country's going bankrupt. We're going to take 10 million, 20 million more and then even let the felons stay here. But we'll get Lou Dobbs on about that. But you're absolutely right. People need to register as Republicans, especially that 50% of the public that never votes. Go register and vote for Ron Paul. You can still vote a split ticket once you get into the general election and vote for whoever you want. It's just now you need to register as Republicans. That's a very important point. Anything else you'd like to add about Ron Paul?
Well, at least get Lou Dobbs not to promote everybody go out and register as an independent, to just make a statement. That's what he was doing, just to make a statement at showing that you're not a Democrat or Republican. Go register and make a statement and register as independent. When people done that, then they couldn't vote for Ron Paul in the primary. That blowed him out bad.
No, anyway, I think that probably didn't help, but I think Dobbs' view was then Paul was not trending as well as he is now, and so Dobbs just saying they're all bad, boycott it, basically, and you know, get out of this two-party system. So I could see his idea there, but certainly not this time. Ron Paul is a top-tier candidate.
If Ron Paul don't win the Republican primary, he'll go independent, and everybody will vote for him then. Anyhow, the other issue I was wanting to bring up real quick. You got a representative, a Republican representative down there in Texas. His name is Lamar Smith. He is the chairman of the House Judiciary Committee. Back about a year ago, I think it was July last year, 2010, he was interviewed by Lou Dobbs and actually was hinted around about actually filing impeachment papers on Obama because of his stance on immigration when he sued Arizona.
Yeah, no, Lamar Smith is my congressman since I moved out of Austin. I live outside Austin, so his district comes right up to Austin. And he does some good things. He's kind of a neocon, but absolutely, why haven't we impeached Obama? I mean, the Super Congress deal, the Libya war without congressional approval, ATF, fast and furious garbage. Bob, there's a bunch of other stuff. The banker bailout part two. I mean, Obama, the health care bill. Well, I guess Congress passed that. They're not going to impeach him for that. Shouldn't Obama be impeached, Bob?
Well, I think there's many things that you've mentioned. But this last one, the Obama Enabling Act, as I call it, crafted after the 1933 National Socialist Adolf Hitler Act, we call it the Budget Control Act of 2011, and the committee that they have there is totally unconstitutional, set up to bypass Congress and allow the President of the United States to become dictator. That's enough.
It's amazing. I can't believe we've gotten to this point. Thank you so much, Jack. God bless. Really good points. Great call. Glad you held. James in California, you're on the air with Bob Chapman. Go ahead.
It's Captain Caveman from Planet Pop-Tart. Just calling to check in.
Good. So you're my boss.
Exactly. So anyways, quickly, so you had a caller call in, I think it was yesterday, from Maryland, saying he was talking to me about false flag and based around some race and a bunch of stuff that they had going on out there. So it's been alleged on various websites. Obviously, I don't think I could prove it, or I'm not sure who could. But at the same time as the Virginia earthquake, Colorado had their earthquake.
No, that's true.
The 5.9 over Virginia. And it's been alleged that apparently those two events, one was right there by Denver, both were about 2.5 miles underneath the surface. And it's been alleged that those the tunnels that go from Denver all the way to Virginia, that these were nukes that were captured and set off underground, and whether or not they were going to be brought above ground to be moved or to be set off, I don't know. I can't prove it. But I was wondering.
Well, look, we know there's underground bases under Colorado and under D.C., and they reportedly do connect. But if they detonated a big nuke, you'd have more than an earthquake. You'd have radioactive isotopes spilling out, and it would have been identified by a university. So if you see that, know what you're looking for. But scientists did say in the Washington Post it was a very rare earthquake, maybe a 100-year, maybe a 200-year event, and then it wasn't where two plates come together. And so if you start seeing more of this, look, governments have these systems. They have it where you can do a oil rig drilling operation inside a warehouse where people can't even see it. You can drill down as little as even 3,000 feet from the maps I've seen and pump plastic explosive in, detonate it. And again, they have maps. Basically, it's like a ground-penetrating sonar they have. So they can, like, actuate key areas of where to trigger, even with a drilling process. And again, as long as you've got a 2 or 3-story building, you can set up one of these rigs, drill it, pump it, and then nobody knows. So that's something governments admittedly have. Then you get into nukes, you get into HAARP and stuff. All I'm saying is it's proven that they can do it with the oil well technologies pumping explosives in. Bob Chapman, any comments?
No, that's kind of out of my field. I'll pass.
We did cover that again yesterday, caller. Had a boil-down article from George Washington blog showing mainstream. Well, the U.S. Geological Survey admitted that just regular oil field and gas field exploration has been proven to trigger earthquakes. I really think people that say nukes did this, if you speculate, that's one thing. But to say in the affirmative, that's like saying this comet Elenin is going to kill us. And then I've seen the tracks people put out, and they've got the comet coming by and its tail hitting us. That isn't how it works. The comet is coming between us and the sun, okay? And so a tail of a comet aims back at the sun, okay, as it goes around. And it's a tiny little comet. And it was in, like, July, people were calling, saying some other planet or something was going to hit us, and I was going to be in a bunker and we wouldn't be here. And then a month later, it's a new one, and then a new one, and a new one, and it'll be this, that. I appreciate your call. Bob, what do you call this phenomenon where people are always obsessed with a new comet or planet that's going to kill us next month?
I don't know, but, there's so many things I've seen in my life that people say, well, this is coming and that's going to happen, and they haven't. And so I certainly take it all with a grain of salt.
Absolutely.
I don't know how they come up with these decisions sometimes.
I think a lot of it's a disinformation campaign, because the same groups every month that say it's a new planet or new comet, then they're right back the next month, and they're either con artists, mentally ill, or they're government operatives, and they're scaring a lot of well-meaning people. Bob Chapman, God bless you. We'll see you back next week, Friday, Lord willing, and I'll see you folks Sunday, 4 to 6.